Wow! What a day. What a day yesterday. And it wasn't a day of which, you know, getting McKinney. Yep, you know what? I'm good with that. Good safety. Josh Jacobs, not a bad way to go. I'm good with that. Younger and got some speed, a lot of good first down opportunities. But in doing so, you lose Aaron Jones. You lose Showtime. And that I was not I got to admit, 70% of me thought that they were not going to get rid of Aaron Jones, that this would be a good 1-2 punch. And that's not the way Brian Gutekunst saw it. So it really, I don't think it necessarily came down to money. I think it came down to more, we're going to get younger and what they believe to be faster. There was a couple of times last year where Aaron Jones broke away from the line of scrimmage and normally would not get caught. And last year got caught. It's the same thing. I had to step back for a minute, but it was the same thing when the Packers decided not to bring back Jordy Nelson. And I got to remember, there are times where as a fan, you become entrenched in being a fan. And I've always called it the heart over head moment, because the NFL, for everything that you cheer for, and for everything that you want and everything that you hope for, is nothing more than a very much cutthroat business. Cutthroat business. It is what it is. And from what I had to step back from what I thought, or maybe what my gut hoped for, to the realization of, you went with younger, faster. That's it. It was a hard decision. And now I have a concern, and I'll tell you what that concern is, but I'm sure it was a hard decision. Goody said it was one of the hardest decisions he's ever made. And now it's time to regroup and move on and bid farewell. And then this morning I get up and I'm flipping through, and I see over on the NFL Network that The Athletic is reporting Aaron Jones is now a Minnesota Viking. And I'm thinking, of course he is. Of course he is. Of course he is. I do not think that the Packers were going to, under hardly any circumstances, keep Aaron Jones. I think they made a decision. I think they made a decision of level of what they believe to be perceived talent, youth, speed, over somebody approaching 30 and looks as if they've lost a step. Now, Aaron Jones getting through the hole, quick as anybody. Quick as anybody. But it's the open field stuff that goes from a 15-yard gain to a 30-yard gain to a touchdown that I think they looked at and said, maybe we can do better. And the fact that, you know, obviously there's, you know, every year there's going to be an injury to Aaron Jones, and they probably looked at the availability factor too. Now, Aaron Jones never played in less than 11 games his entire career. So I had a guy yesterday coming at me, goes, he only plays in 8 games a year anyway, and he's slow and he's old. And it's like, no. And first of all, I can't believe you hit enter. You can't call yourself a Packers fan because you don't understand it. And oh, by the way, you might want to just take a look at his statistics. So I really believe that's what happened. They looked at it and said, let's get a little faster, let's get a little younger. And that's exactly what they did. And sure enough, in come the Minnesota Vikings to say, hey, there's another guy that's beaten us. Maybe he's a little faster on turf. Let's throw him in our lineup and see what happens. But they've also got Sam Darnold as their quarterback. They don't have Kirk Cousins anymore because he's now gone. He went to Atlanta yesterday. So a lot to get to. David Bakhtiari gone. Aaron Jones gone. Are the Packers better today than they were yesterday? And we'll ask that question as well. We'll also get your thoughts on all of that. If you want to hit us up, 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. If you want to give us a call, you can also find us over on X @Bill_Michaels, or at Wisco Grant, Instagram, The Bill Michaels Show, The Bill Michaels Show over on Instagram, Facebook. Go to facebook.com/The Bill Michaels Show. And don't forget over on YouTube, great way to follow the program, great way to subscribe. And every time you subscribe, first of all, it's free. That's the best part about it. Secondly, when you do subscribe, when we go on the air, even if you forget to turn us on, it'll remind you, hey, we've just gone live and we're good to go. So you can watch us there. YouTube.com/Bill Michaels Show. Same thing on TikTok. Same thing on Kick. LinkedIn TV as well. You can find us email-wise, TheBillMichaels@gmail.com. That's TheBillMichaels@gmail.com. Simply the website, TheBillMichaels.com. And then listen to us, download us via the Zone app. The Zone Madison, the Zone, Z-O-N-E, the Zone Madison, or after the fact on Apple iTunes, Google Podcasts, Spotify, all that kind of good stuff. You can track us down there as well. Grant Bills, how you feeling today?
I'm doing good. I'm a little, if I'm being honest, Bill, I'm a little sick of my favorite players and favorite sports figures going to join rival teams. I'm getting a little sick of that.
Yeah.
Other than that, having a great day.
I don't have a problem with it. I don't like it, but it wasn't like Aaron Jones said, no, I want to go to the Vikings. Aaron Jones got cut. I mean, was that it? You know, I really believe that there's a shelf life for running backs in the National Football League. He was sitting upon it. And I think they just said, we've got an opportunity to get younger and faster, and that's what we're going to do. And I really believe that's all it came down to. I don't think it was, you know, because Aaron Jones wanted to stay in Green Bay. He's made it clear. It wasn't like Aaron Jones said, no, I'm not taking any kind of a pay cut. No, I'm not going to restructure. No, I'm not doing that. I think he wanted to stay. And I just think they said, you know what? Last year there was a couple of opportunities where he had open field and he wasn't able to break it. He did it in Chicago and pulled the hammy. Then later in the season, he had a couple of opportunities, specifically in a game against the 49ers, and wasn't able to take it to the house. And I think at that point in time, they went, oof, we might be seeing the beginning of the end of a running back in the National Football League. And Ted Thompson and Brian Gutekunst, and that philosophy has always been, you'd rather get rid of a player a year too soon than a year too late. And that's the reason they probably cut him loose when they saw the opportunity. So I'm not happy about it. But I don't blame, you know, it's like people are pissed off at Saquon Barkley in New York for going to the Eagles. It's like, you know what? He begged for years and the Giants wouldn't pay him. I mean, the Giants have nobody to blame but themselves. And if you're going to blame anybody, blame the organization. In this particular case, Brian Gutekunst made a big business decision and just said, I think we're going to go in a different direction. I think I'm going to try to get faster and younger. And that's what they did. So.
I mean, they wanted him to take a 50% pay cut from $12 million, which would be about $6 million, unless they asked Aaron Jones to do that, knowing that he would never do it and right. Knowing it would lead. Maybe they wanted to cut him all along. I hadn't considered that. But if what was reported is true and the Packers wanted to pay him around $6 million, which is a 50% pay cut, he went to the Vikings for $1 million more. Like, that's what I struggle with. If there's a market for you, go out and get your money. But you joined a rival to make, you know, peanuts basically in comparison. $7 million, $6 million, what's the difference? I know it's $1 million and I, you know, go get your money, but it's not like he went and got a massive deal elsewhere.
I'm Nostalgic says Jones is being petty about this. How's he being petty? And you're not re-signing AJ Dillon. Stop it. He's slow and plodding. That's not happening. But how is Aaron Jones being petty? He'd taken pay cuts. He'd taken restructures. I mean, maybe he didn't want to take a 50% pay cut. Okay. And maybe he thought he'd get a little bit more in the open market and then realized that all the money that was being doled out to higher end running backs, it wasn't going to happen. So, but I don't know how he's being petty. He's been a great Packer. Here's where I have an issue with this. Is that he was, you know, I was watching Tim Van Voren this morning on Fox 6 and Tim called him the heart and soul of the Packers, the new face of the Packers. And he was the guy that said all along, even when Aaron Rodgers was there, that, hey, once Jordan gets going, we got his back. He was the guy that said, let's go work out. He was the guy that kind of put the bug in his ear to bring everybody together. He was the guy that all along said, no, we're playing for this guy. We're going to play for this guy. So, and he was just a spectacular community guy. He's everything you wanted to be in a Packer. So the whole thing about anger and screw you, and from what I've seen from some Packers fans, it's like, I don't get it, man. I really don't get it. If you were trying to hang on at the end of your career and somebody came to you and said, take a 50% pay cut, you know, wouldn't you find it a little offensive for everything you've done for the community and everything you've done for the team? I would. You know, I don't know. I mean, I'm not in that world, but I don't blame them at all. Not at all. For I mean, again, it's the Vikings. Who cares? Brett Favre went there and people got over it. Suck it up, people. Favre, here's the difference. Aaron Jones got cut and got an offer, took the offer. Brett Favre wanted to orchestrate his ability to go to Minnesota to come back and kick Ted Thompson's ass. That's what he wanted to do. And he still, when he came back to get his number retired, everybody was gushing over him. So I don't want to hear it. It's not like all of a sudden I'm an anti, you know, Packers fan or something. No, it's just, I get it. It's a business. And I think they made a business decision. Apparently, I guess Aaron Jones tweeted a bunch of stuff out and then deleted it this morning. Did you read any of that, Grant?
Sorry, I was talking to a couple callers. Did I read what?
Did you read anything that Aaron Jones tweeted out and then deleted this morning?
Oh, I didn't see that he deleted it. I saw that he tweeted that there's three sides to every story,
yeah,
or whatever. Interesting.
Yeah. And let's not forget, he's got Drew Rosenhaus as an agent. You know, so it's, you know, Drew Rosenhaus is very much a fold my arms and say, no, I'm not doing that kind of guy, too. I mean, he doesn't always do it. He's had more reasonability, but Drew Rosenhaus is much like Scott Boras. He is not there to make a lot of deals to benefit you. So I think they said, take this pay cut, if that's indeed what happened. And they also wanted to get younger, and they also wanted to get faster, because you're creeping up on a running back at the age of 30. I just think that's it. Let's do this. Okay. We'll take a quick break. We'll come back. We'll start getting into phone calls and all that kind of good stuff. What I want to do, there's a lot of stuff going on. First of all, you got the Bucks in Sacramento coming up tonight. Congratulations to UWM, the Panthers, in the finals down in Indianapolis, taking on Oakland tonight, 6 o'clock Central. If they win, they're in the NCAA tournament. So what we thought might have been Green Bay, who stubbed their toe down the stretch but still had a tremendous season, kudos to them, UWM finds themselves in the finals tonight, taking on Oakland. If they win, they're in. I mean, that's exciting. I can't wait for that tonight. So you got Bucks in Sacramento, winning, you're in, UWM Panthers, and then the rest of it's all going to fall into line. Stay tuned. We got a whole lot more of the Bill Michaels Show, and then we're going to take phone calls and everything on this, so don't go anywhere. Stick around. We got a whole lot more coming up right after this. Don't go anywhere. We've got a lot of good stuff today. I'm telling you, we do.
Ready? This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
0% interest for up to 3 years at Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin. I'm Gina Della from Pella. Pella's free in-home consultations make replacing or redesigning your windows and doors easy. We go beyond just measuring and handing you a quote. We take the time to listen and educate you on all your product options. And with Design Works, you can see what your home will look like before you buy. Whether you're looking to replace your windows due to damage, or it's time for a refresh and you'd like to revitalize your home style, choosing from Pella's wide range of windows and doors will complement your home's unique design. Pella can also customize, providing nearly endless possibilities for maximum design flexibility with dramatic sizes, custom colors, finishes, profiles, product types, and more. Order by March 31st to get 0% interest for up to 3 years. Set your free consultation at PellaWI.com.
Certain restrictions apply.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes.
We'll be right back.
Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Welcome back to the program, The Bill Michaels Show. On this kind of a tough day for a lot of people. Aaron Jones gone, David Bakhtiari gone. This portion of the program brought to you by our friends at Duane's, D-U-A-N-E-S, Duane's Cover It All, and located in Wausau. Whether it's boat covers, bimini tops, travel covers, whatever it happens to be, upholstery, he can do it. Awnings, let's just say an awning out in front of your business, or maybe something over top of your patio, he can do that as well. Gym equipment, office furniture, and so much more. If you're a company trying to save a few bucks, and rather than going out and buying all new office chairs, have them reupholstered, have them redone, he can do that too. Armrests, everything, he can do that. Go to Duane's, D-U-A-N-E-S, duanescoveritall.com, up in Wausau, 715-870-2119, 715-870-2119. That's duanescoveritall.com. That's duanescoveritall.com. I personally, I don't really have this, animosity towards Aaron Jones for leaving. I guess some do, but I really don't. I think he's been nothing but a great ambassador for the Green Bay Packers. I think he has been a hell of a player. He has had, let's be honest, he's had some injury issues. So he's been a terrific player when he's healthy and he's available. When he's not healthy, fully healthy, he's not the same player. But when you listen to Brian Gutekunst speak, you're going to hear, heart and soul and, leadership and such and what they've done. But, I'm getting a lot of people that say, please explain to me why Josh Jacobs is better. He's younger. He's faster. It's all you need to know. He's younger. He's faster. Doesn't have the same injury history. Once you get a guy that's a running back past the quarter point of their season, past the three-quarter point, of their career, you really start to look over the fence for somebody else. Running backs, there's very few that have sustainability. There's very few that have the ability to run and run well after the age of 30. And I really honestly believe that's the majority of what this is. Mike Clemens standing by, giving us a buzz. Mike, what you got for us? Michael.
Hi, Bill.
So tough day yesterday, losing Aaron Jones.
Well, don't make me your free agency insider, because my gut was Goody was going to go back to the mode where he'll wait for 2 weeks for the prices to come down. And then like an hour and a half after I say that, he spends over $100 million on two players.
So, right.
But this is where he feels he's got his opportunity. They've made some salary cap space. It's an amazing day that he picks up Josh Jacobs from the Raiders, who's 3 years younger and still got a lot of burst and explosiveness in him. And then the turnaround, and they let Aaron Jones go. Now people are thinking, well, Aaron Jones, Drew Rosenhaus, they're signing him in spite. No, that's the last thing. The coach in Minnesota thinks that this guy can help him out in the next year or two, because they just lost their quarterback, Kirk Cousins, and they don't really have a plan there. And this is the same team that cut Dalvin Cook a year ago when he was pretty much in the same shape as Aaron Jones is right now in terms of the stage of his career. The Packers know what's going on with Aaron Jones and his knees. I mean, they went through that all last season, although everyone was excited at the burst that he had in the last month. But at the end of the day, it's another Packer. And, the Vikings are around their third or fourth general manager since Ziggy Wolf bought the team. They keep on getting, Dayton Jones. Remember how you were upset about that?
Right, right.
Za'Darius Smith, who was one and done there. And the Greg Jennings thing, you've had Greg on firsthand many times. Actually, part of that saga was broken on this show about, look, they offered me the best deal. It wasn't like, yeah, I went to the Vikings. They called and they wanted me to. Charles Woodson, remember him? He wanted to go to the Jaguars, and the only offer Charles Woodson was getting out of the Raiders was Ted Thompson and the Green Bay Packers. So, to only go for 1 year and $7 million in the Vikings, is that something that Gutekunst turned down? I don't think so. But, there's a template in Green Bay that says running backs are 4-year contracts.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, they have to be really, really good to get a second contract. And the third contract, highly doubtful. And that's just the way they look at the position. You want a good running back is in his second or third year in the NFL. That's it.
And, well, I just said, when people say, why is Josh Jacobs a better opportunity? He's younger and faster. I mean, that's it. That's all you need to know.
That's it. And then probably, and he's had injuries as well, but it's not as bad. And I also think that they take a look at what he was able to do with a bad offensive line,
right,
and the immense turnover they've had. And, oh, by the way, you've got an insider right there, Rich Bisaccia, who worked with the guy for a couple of years.
Yeah.
So you got all that information on Josh Jacobs and what can he do to replace Aaron Jones and possibly A.J. Dillon.
So, Mike, like you said, they spent a lot of money. They have really kind of fortified two specific needs. One, I thought it was going to be a great 1-2 punch, but it turns out that Josh Jacobs is just going to be the man, and then they're going to find somebody else to fill in behind him. Whether they go in a different direction via the draft or something, we'll have to wait and see. But let's talk about the secondary for a minute, because McKinney is the real deal. I was going over film of him yesterday after I got off the air, and that guy's got some hops to him.
They're 24 years old, and obviously they think that he's going to be also be the smart guy back there,
yeah,
to help direct the back end of that defense, and that's going to be important for them as well. I mean, I get a chance to see these guys up close and personable here in a month or so, when they're in Green Bay, and, ask me about a week or two after that, and I'll tell you what I think. But there's a process here. I'm not defending it. I still would have thought there would have, like most fans, for about 30 minutes yesterday, he thought, oh, great, Jacobs and Jones in the backfield. That's nice. And then not so much.
Right.
Not so much. But, I could just see Drew Rosenhaus saying, look, he's not trying to hook up his client with somebody that's in spite. He's calling around, and that's the best offer he got for his client.
Yeah.
1 year and $7 million. Across the street with the Vikings. And I'm sure that, the owners think, oh, we'll get all these inside secrets. But, Kevin up there is the head coach. He's looking for a guy that can fit in his offense and his McVay style offense.
You know, Mike, I was sitting here this morning, really yesterday, and I heard all the news, you know, break, and then, you know, Aaron Jones is gone. They cut him loose. And my heart is this fan. And I say, you know what? How can you do this? I mean, he's the heart and soul. He's the guy that really stuck up for Jordan Love. And he's become such an incredible, blitz pickup guy, blocker, running back. Really, he was the straw that stirred the drink at the end of the season. And he's a terrific outlet pass guy. And I'm like, there's no way. And plus, he's a fan favorite. He's the sombrero. He's the kid. He's Showtime, you know, and he does so much in the community. And then I'm thinking to myself exactly what you said. Third contracts, 30 years old, clearly has lost a step. Had a couple of opportunities. One, when he did break one free, he ended up pulling a hamstring down in Chicago. And then later in the season, twice, specifically against San Francisco in the postseason, he got into open field and couldn't outrun the defensive backs when in the past he had. And I thought,
I remember that. We said that in the press box.
Yeah. Yeah. And I said, I said, that's very reminiscent of Jordy Nelson when Jordy was still good, but it lost a step. And I thought, okay, that's exactly what Goody saw. And I just glossed over it because I've got more green and gold goggles on than anything. And so he probably looked at it and said, 30 years old, making quite a bit of money, has all lost a step. It's time to move on.
I think his birthday's in December. I think he's still 29, but whatever the case,
right?
All those things, I underline everything you just say. Those are all the things there. And, and a very tough decision, but if you're Brian Gutekunst, you have the x-rays, you know, the actual status of those knees. You also have this core belief, like, you know, running backs are in their second or third year in the NFL. Go get somebody now. You got Emmanuel Wilson coming back for a second year. Maybe there's something he could do that you plucked off undrafted, you know, a bonus that you got there. You know, as for the Vikings, I don't understand. They did it the right way when they picked up Dalvin Cook and developed him, and he was a pain for the Packers for many years. And then he got to the point where it's, you know what, one more year is 2 years too many. And they let him go. And where's he now? I lost track where he is after he went to the Jets. So yeah. I hope, you know, I don't understand why there wasn't possibly a market for the Cowboys since Tony Pollard went to the Titans.
Right.
That maybe Aaron Jones could have slipped in there, but it doesn't look like it's going to be that way. So I just want to give you those 2 cents.
Yep. Mike, great stuff as always. And anything breaks, we'll talk to you again real soon. Okay.
Thank you, pal.
All right, buddy. There you go. That's the great Mike Clemens giving us his thoughts and kind of staying. Skinny says, but you say he lost his set, but he's still good enough for another team. So what? So was Jordy Nelson, and his career dwindled to nothing after he ended up going to Las Vegas, to the Raiders. He had one good season, and after that, he was done. So what? It doesn't matter. I mean, teams are going to take flyers on other guys that have made a name for themselves somewhere. But just because you're not good enough to play for the Packers and another team picks you up doesn't mean you're going to be great. He may be good this year. He may be really good. But it's the longevity that they're looking at. They went younger and faster. That's what they do. You can be mad about it all you want. You can kind of try to twist it into whatever it is you want to believe. But, you know, well, the Jets, they picked up Randall Cobb, right? Alan Lazard, the Jets picked up Alan Lazard, right? Wasn't good enough for the Packers, but he was certainly good enough for Rodgers and the Jets. And you saw what happened. He was a healthy scratch. Didn't even play. How many times have we seen Dalvin Cook went to the Jets? He was healthy enough to get picked up by the Jets after he left a tremendous career in Minnesota. You see where he's at now. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. If you want to give us a shout, please feel free to go ahead and do so. Stick around because we're going to start taking phone calls. I know there's a lot of people on hold that want to chime in on all of this stuff, and rightfully so. And we'll start taking the calls when we come back. This portion of the program brought to you by our friends at The Water Doctors. John Atley and his staff, big supporters of the motorcycle ride. We've got a lot of good stuff we're ready to announce, too. We're just crossing the T's and dotting the I's. As soon as everything is signed, we're going to let you know. But and we can't make one announcement until May 1st, but we've got a mystery guest this year, too, coming. Oh, can't wait for that. Anyway, that being said, they're a big supporter of the motorcycle ride coming up on Sunday, September 1st. Put it on your calendar. You're going to want to be there. And we're going to have an opportunity, even if you don't ride, to still come and support. So we're going to try to include everybody in this one. But tickets will be limited once they go on sale. I want to let you know that, hint, hint. Water Doctors, huge supporter, H2, the letter O, H2Odoctors.com. And, oh, by the way, they have the best water softening system out there. That's the Kinetico water softening system. So anywhere in the state of Wisconsin, call them, 262-549-7733, 262-549-7733. And if you're like me and you love to drink water, and I do, I love the reverse osmosis, the clean, the fresh, the tasteless drinking water that comes out of the reverse osmosis every damn day here at the house. I have always have one sitting next to me when I'm here on the air. That's our friends at the Water Doctors, H2, the letter O, doctors.com, or call them 262-549-7733.
This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Make it a real Mad March with a playoff payout at Pottawatomie. Every week, you could score your share of 100 grand in cash and free play. Play this March for drawing entries. Win each Thursday. Plus, the prizes refresh every week for even more winners. The playoff payout at Pottawatomie, Milwaukee. It's anyone's game. For more details, visit paysbig.com/payout. Must be 21 and a club member to play.
Bill Michaels will resume in 5 minutes. Michaels will resume in 4 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. We'll be right back. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Good to have you back, the Bill Michaels Show. Kind of say thanks to our friends at Quick Trip. And don't forget, if you go to quicktrip.com/chicken for life, you got an opportunity to win some chicken, that good fried chicken that they have for life. Not kidding. And the stuff, whether it's the tenders, which are huge, the actual chicken, you can get a whole chicken, you can get, you know, fried chicken, you can get chicken tenders, you can get chicken type of nuggets, you can get them in buffalo. So, I mean, there's so much chicken. It's all good at Quick Trip, and I'm on the road today. I'm out and about, got a lot going on. So I went yesterday to Robert's Specialty Meats and I bought some stuff. But if I don't make it back in time and I can't grill out like I want to, Quick Trip is my stop without a doubt. So thanks to our friends for Quick Trip for being right then and there all the time. Time now to talk a little bit about what's going on in Minnesota, because Minnesota is, they're looking for a quarterback. They've seemingly found one in Sam Darnold, but how good is he going to be? They lose Kirk Cousins. Matthew Collier, the Purple Insider, joining us on the highlight. Matthew, how you doing?
I'm good. Do they make you say chicken like that, or is that like you?
That is me, and I love that stuff. I got to be honest with you. I'm like addicted to it. So you're one of – look – when I come to Minnesota, there's two things I stop at. One is Quick Trip, and the other one is Antigo's. So both of those are on my radar every time I come in that direction. So let's talk.
I can feel the passion.
Yes.
I can really feel the passion.
Yes. Let's talk about, first and foremost, give me the state of where this team is. I mean, they lose Kirk Cousins. They pick up Sam Darnold, and then they go out and get a running back to fill in, because obviously Alexander Mattison is gone. But what are they doing right now? If you had to say, I'm going to put my thumb on what the Vikings are doing, what are they doing right now?
I think that they are sticking to the plan that was laid out when Kwesi Adofo-Mensah and Kevin O'Connell took over their leadership in 2022. I mean, they wanted to try to compete in 2022. They knew the division was down. They thought they had a chance. They also thought if they increased the culture and made it a little bit nicer of a place to work, they might win some more games. And then they tore down last year major parts of their roster and set themselves up to draft a quarterback this year. I think that was their three-year plan from when they started. And when you look back to last year, they negotiated a little bit with Kirk Cousins on an extension, but ultimately didn't sign him. So it shouldn't be shocking that he left, because they had their opportunity after he won 13 games to give him the big monster $100 million guaranteed deal. And they said, no, we're not going to do that because you're an older, middling type of quarterback. And apparently the Falcons don't mind, but the Vikings did not have that in their plans. So now they're set up to spend a lot of free agency money, which they have not had a chance to do since Kirk has been there. And so they're rebuilding their defense with guys who are in their mid to late 20s, still in their prime, with three signings on the defensive side. And I think Aaron Jones is kind of a bit of a luxury signing for them. A little bit of like when you get your mortgage paid off, that you go out and buy yourself the biggest ribeye you can find. I think that's getting Aaron Jones here. But they need a better running game if they're going to draft a quarterback as well. You can't ask a quarterback to do what Kirk did and have the 27th best running game like the Vikings did last year. So I think it's all kind of coming together the way they envisioned it. And what will ultimately determine success or failure is pretty simple. It's what they end up doing in the draft at the quarterback position.
Who do you think that they are targeting, if anybody specific?
I think that Drake May, if there was any opportunity to trade up, that they would gather all the draft capital and ship it to Washington or New England if they had a chance. He just makes so much sense for Kevin O'Connell. Big arm. He's a good athlete. Kind of reminds you a little bit of Matthew Stafford when he was coming out of college, and that's who Kevin O'Connell won the Super Bowl with. So you could see that being a great combination. Of course, though, they pick 11th. Getting up that far would take a lot. So I think the next best option for them is probably J.J. McCarthy, who's getting a ton of buzz, and maybe the Giants want him. So you might have to trade up to even get J.J. McCarthy, but not give up the whole franchise. But with bringing in Sam Darnold, it gives them a little bit of wiggle room to draft someone like McCarthy, pretend they're the Packers a little bit and develop the guy for a year and then have him ready to play in 2025. But I also think this is just a draft that has a lot of guys you can like. I mean, you watch Michael Penix and his arm talent, or you look at the numbers Bo Nix put up, and you know, some of these guys are kind of being treated like second-class prospects, but they're better than a lot of the prospects that we've seen in the past go in the first round. So I think the Vikings have had their eye on this class for a couple of years, and we're leading up to this to have this opportunity to pick their guy.
How much now? I know he's cost a lot of money, but what are fans saying? Because I've said all along, look, you're talking about Kirk Cousins, and he's been a tremendous quarterback during the regular season. You've got a guy that's $330 million into a career and has only won one playoff game. So, I mean, is there a lot of, are you kidding me, that he's now gone and no longer a Minnesota Viking going on?
I think that Vikings fans feel like they have walked out into the fresh air because they've just heard the same old things over and over again over the last 6 years of, well, you know, if Kirk only had a better left guard, if Kirk only had a better offensive coordinator, if he only had a coach who liked him, if he only had a defense, if only. And as you mentioned, he has fewer playoff wins in his career than Baker Mayfield does. And yet he's been playing for a long time.
Right.
And he's made a lot of money. And they made the playoffs 2 times in 6 years during his tenure. Is that competing? I don't think so. Would the Packers organization say that's competing? No, I wouldn't think so. So I think for Vikings fans, they got very exhausted and frustrated by having a quarterback that's good and not great. It's the worst place you can live. It's where the Raiders lived with Derek Carr for a very long time. Those guys can fool you into thinking that, no, yeah, if you just do this or that, he can really take you somewhere. Well, not at $40 million a year, he can't. So, I mean, that's where you look at, you know, the 49ers, the Eagles, teams that have built around these rookie quarterback contracts. That's what the Vikings are looking to do. And I think fans are just more informed than ever. And they understand this, that like, this is the way to go. This is how teams are winning in the NFL. And so I don't think it's like sayonara loser. I mean, I think the fans liked Kirk Cousins overall and rooted for him, but also realized that it was just not the way to get anywhere in the NFL. And, you know, congratulations to the Atlanta Falcons on their 9-8 season upcoming.
Let me ask you this, because I've got people that are asking me, is there anything to the notion, or I'm watching right now on the NFL Network and the rumors and innuendos flying around, would there be anything to Justin Fields wearing purple next year?
Doesn't make a bit of sense to me, man. But, you know, I guess, like, if you're the Vikings, you have to investigate every option. And maybe there's some sort of price where if it's like the same price that Mac Jones went for, if you're talking about a day 3 pick, then maybe, but I still don't get it. Like, the guy's 10-28 in his career. He gets sacked at a rate that's higher than David Carr. Remember the Texans quarterback who got sacked all the time? Well, actually, Fields gets sacked more often than him. So I don't see that as a fit for a coach who loves a rhythm and timing offense like Kevin O'Connell. That's where a big-armed quarterback like Sam Darnold makes more sense, even if he hasn't had a ton of success so far in his career. But Justin Fields hasn't done anything more than Sam Darnold or Mac Jones did, and Chicago fans are treating him like he's incredible. It's very bizarre how much they fell in love with this guy who has never even thrown for 2,600 yards. Like, what year is it?
Right.
Guys were throwing for 26 yards in 1985.
Which I completely agree with. I think he had a couple of good games down the stretch, and they thought he was going to just get his price driven up to some kind of magnanimous proportion. And he's at best maybe a sixth-round draft choice at this point and really hasn't proven too much in Chicago. And I'll be quite honest with you. What we were told behind the scenes is that he's not the sharpest knife in the drawer anyway. So I don't know necessarily what franchise is going to take a big flyer on Justin Fields. However, what needs to be done in Minnesota still? Because you've obviously still got a tremendous wide receiver in Justin Jefferson. You just pick up Aaron Jones, who can be a receiver out of the backfield. He's still got a burst. He doesn't have the same level of speed, breakaway speed that he used to have, but he's still got a good burst and still can churn out yardage. What else needs to be done, maybe even to the defensive side of things in Minnesota?
And can we just stop for a minute and just to like marvel at how many times this has happened with a Packer being disgruntled, right, and being like, no, I'm going to Quick Trip in Minnesota. That's what I'm going to do. Like, it's so funny. I mean, how often this happens. It gives us a little spice for a revenge game. But there's a lot to do. They signed three defensive players, a couple pass rushers, linebacker. But they need defensive tackle badly. So if you want to cut Kenny Clark, the Vikings would take him as well. But, that guy is just like, they finally got rid of Fletcher Cox in Philly. Now if only Kenny Clark can retire. But they need a defensive tackle badly. They need a left guard. They don't have a starting left guard. And the guard prices all of a sudden are absolutely insane. So I think they're going to have to wait for that. So this is under construction. Like, you can see the build happening. But I think it's not until really next offseason where they can go completely wild in their spending. So this is going to be still, I think, a transition year for the Vikings overall.
Always good to talk to you. We appreciate all the information. I'm sure we'll touch base back as the draft is upon us, okay?
Yep, good to talk to you, man.
You too. Thanks, Matthew. Appreciate it. Matthew Coller joining us for a couple of minutes from the Purple Insider. You can find him at Matthew Coller, C-O-L-L-E-R, over on X, and track his stuff down there. But it covers the Minnesota Vikings. Our guy Paul Charchian, the Charch, from up in Minneapolis, will join us a little bit later on as well, and we'll pick his brain. Charch is always good because he's kind of wired in with just about everybody because of the fantasy side of things, so he gets a little bit better read on some of the stats and such, and we'll talk with him about what's going on there and what to expect in Green Bay as well. I want to ask him about Josh Jacobs. I want to ask him about McKinney also, so we'll get into that discussion when we come back. So don't go anywhere. I promise you, phone calls, that's coming up. Don't go anywhere. More of the Bill Michael Show. It's all coming up next.
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket, this is the Bill Michael Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
0% interest for up to 3 years at Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin. I'm Gina Della from Pella. Pella's free in-home consultations make replacing or redesigning your windows and doors easy. We go beyond just measuring and handing you a quote. We take the time to listen and educate you on all your product options. And with Design Works, you can see what your home will look like before you buy. Whether you're looking to replace your windows due to damage or it's time for a refresh and you'd like to revitalize your home style, choosing from Pella's wide range of windows and doors will complement your home's unique design. Pella can also customize, providing nearly endless possibilities for maximum design flexibility with dramatic sizes, custom colors, finishes, profiles, product types, and more. Order by March 31st to get 0% interest for up to 3 years. Set your free consultation at PellaWI.com.
Certain restrictions apply.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Welcome back. Coming up on Sunday, September 1st, the motorcycle ride benefiting Fisher House, Wisconsin. We are a proud supporter thereof, and we are looking forward to it. And the details are fastly coming together. And as soon as we can finish announcing, as soon as we sign all the contracts and we get, this is going to be our biggest ever. And we're going to have a terrific party. It's going to be at Lux Golf Bays and down in the Franklin Commons, the ballpark commons area, from our friends at Rock Venture. And we have got some really, really fun things planned. And I don't want to say spectacular, because in the grand scheme of things, as opposed to, say, like Bruce Springsteen showing up, it's smaller than that, but it's bigger than most. So, and we're going to continue the moniker of the largest annual motorcycle ride in the state of Wisconsin. And we're going to grow it this year. We're going to grow it by leaps and bounds. And we got a lot of cool stuff planned. So check out our friends at Lux. And maybe you just want to go down and get your swing on for, if you want to golf, L-U-X-E, luxgolfbays.com. That's luxgolfbays.com. Again, luxgolfbays.com, down with the Rock Ventures Group. Down there in Franklin, Wisconsin, and we got a lot of good stuff that we're going to do with them. All right, let's do this. Let's get to the phone calls. I know we only got a couple of minutes. Let's go to Tyler in Brookfield. Tyler, how you doing, man? What's going on?
Doing good, Bill. How's it going?
Doing great. What are you thinking?
You know, I'm just riding the roller coaster, you know, same as everybody else. But whether Gutekunst in the front office wanted to keep Jones or not, they were right in their evaluation on his price point. You know, whether he felt slighted by that or not, you know. Obviously, the market told you what he was worth, and that was about the, you know, the $6 to $7 million range. And obviously, and I can understand the why if he's upset, you know, everything like what he's done for the Green Bay community, but you know, it's a business, and So he's got to get what he thinks he's worth. And obviously, the market said he was worth about what Brian Gutekunst said he was worth. And I just want to know, obviously, I think they should get the running back from Tennessee in the draft. I think, you know, I don't know if you checked him out or not there, Jalen Wright. He's only 20 years old, and you know how much the Packers love the players that are young. And he's like a 9.8 RAS score. So, you know, how much you're kind of like the young players that are super athletic.
Yeah, it's interesting. I appreciate the phone call. The other guy that gets kicked around a lot is, as far as the name goes, is everybody right here in our own backyard would say Braylon Allen. He's the next guy that a lot of people would love to see come into the Packers organization. And obviously, you know, being a Wisconsinite and such, everybody would love to see that. And So I don't put it past them. I know they're going to draft a running back or two. That I know. Because you're not going to stand pat to where it's at. But most people seem to think, and I want to go back to what happened yesterday. In free agency, there's a lot of, and Lewis Riddick, I know, had huge praise, said that Josh Jacobs could take the Packers to a whole other level. To a whole other level after Aaron Jones gets cut loose, that Josh Jacobs is, he can be a punisher. He's got good wheels. He's younger, a little more durable. And even though backs are somewhat undervalued, although yesterday, certainly I don't want to say the market started to level itself out, but certainly there became a little bit more demand. But there's a lot of people that just feel that the Packers really, between McKinney and the secondary, and they took a step forward yesterday, that the Packers did all the right things. Stick around. We'll come back with phone calls and such coming up after the top of the hour. Don't go anywhere. We're going to get to everybody, I promise you. More of the Bill Michaels Show at hand right after this.
This is a Wisconsin Sports Zone update.
Well, the Packers had a whirlwind of moves yesterday to begin the free agency negotiation period. It started with David Bakhtiari announcing he was going to be released by the team. The five-time All-Pro was the longest tenured player on the roster, having been with the club since 2013. Then the news came the team was signing Raiders free agent running back Josh Jacobs, one of the top backs on the market, getting $48 million over 4 years, and many thought he'd paired with Aaron Jones, only to find out a short time later the Packers were cutting Jones after 7 years and more than 8,000 total yards and 63 touchdowns. GM Brian Gutekunst said it was one of the toughest decisions of his career. Then Gutekunst and his staff agreed to a deal with Giants safety Xavier McKinney for a four-year, $68 million contract. McKinney was one of the top safeties on the market and a top priority for the team. There was also some moves on a lesser scale, as a couple of Packers free agents, guard John Runyon, went to the Giants and Darnell Savage to Jacksonville. Now, none of these deals can actually be signed, though, until tomorrow when the new league year begins.
Rural Mutual Insurance, keeping Wisconsin strong.
Rural Mutual is the number one farm insurer in Wisconsin for a good reason. As a company founded by farmers, they understand the ag industry and its challenges. Local agents offer farm families the best advice and personalized coverage. Visit ruralmutual.com to find an agent near you.
Rural Mutual Insurance, keeping Wisconsin strong.
Last Wednesday, the Milwaukee Bucks went out west and are looking to finish their road trip 500. They would fall to the Warriors and the Lakers, beat the Clippers on Sunday. Now we'll finish off in Sacramento against the Kings for a 9 o'clock tip. And finally, Wisconsin basketball is in the Big Ten tournament as a 5 seed. They'll take on the winner of Rutgers and Maryland Thursday. For the Wisconsin Sports Zone Network, I'm Ebo.
Hour number one, flew past. We are now in hour number two. Bill Michaels Show. After yesterday's flurry of free agent activity, and the Packers, two long-standing, staunch figures, David Bakhtiari and Aaron Jones, both cut loose yesterday. You got Devondre Campbell out as well. The Packers are making moves. They're getting younger. They're getting faster. Obviously, they're trying to get healthier. That's another area in which they go. So a lot of movement yesterday via the Green Bay Packers. So let's do this. Let's get back to the phone calls because a lot of people on hold. I want to get to all of them as quick as I possibly can. Let's go to our buddy Gerard. Gerard, what's going on, man? How you doing?
Hey, Bill. On the East Coast, they're saying that McKinney was offered 13.5 by the Giants. So the Packers didn't want to go back and forth. And they just blew him out of the water with a $17 million offer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And this is what's great about the Packers now. They're willing to go that way. And they're willing, when they want to play, to outbid other teams for him. And as far as better a year too early than a year too late, you know, I said that all along, and I heard you say it before, and I couldn't agree with you more. And I tell you what, if people think that it's difficult to get rid of Jones and everything, Favre is gone, Rodgers is gone, the whole bit. So there has been even bigger players than him, and there will be even bigger players than him that will be let go. And it was a smart move, no matter what anybody says. So look, they're going to look. They're still $30 million below the cap. So they got that to spend. Now, they'll probably keep some of that to Love. They still can extend Clark. They still can do a few things. And I'm looking at it this way. I think they're going to draft two running backs relatively early because these teams are knowing that these running backs can come cheap in a draft.
Mm-hmm.
So I think with their first pick in the second round, they're going to pick a running back. And then in the third, they're going to pick another one with their second pick in the third. So that's what I'm looking at because they're going to need depth at these guys. And one of the running backs they pick is probably going to be able to do a lot of kick returning. So that's the way I would be looking at it. And I think, still, they might go, I meant to tell you, they're bringing in another safety from the who used to be with the Jaguars in for a visit. I don't know if you heard that or whatever.
I read something about that in like a post or something earlier today when I was kind of perusing Twitter and such.
Right. But the Eagles, now look at what the Eagles did, right? The Eagles sign Barkley, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then they go out and they sign a designated pass rusher. So, and look what the Giants did. They spent $150 million, but yet they didn't keep their safety on Burns in the trade that they made. And look how dumb the Panthers are, because a couple of years ago, or a year ago or so, they could have got two number ones for Burns. Now they ended up with a second and a fifth. So look at how some of the dumb moves that some of these teams make.
Mm-hmm.
And the Packers right now, they got the two-year window coming up, they think, before they're going to have to pay these receivers and everybody else.
Right.
So this is why they're doing this. So
100%.
Well, you know, Bill, I think they're going to sign another guy. I don't know who it is. You know what? I have a funny feeling that they're going to make another splash. I have a funny feeling. You know what I mean? So Hunt is still out there. I don't know, Bill. I think
they're still sitting. I think you just said it, but they're still sitting. Correct me if I'm wrong. They're still sitting on about 31 to 35 million bucks.
30 million. That's
yeah.
Right. 30 mil.
So,
and they still can make moves, Bill.
Yeah.
They can extend Clark. They could get more money there. They could get more money from Alexander. They can make more money. They could get more money from other guys.
And so, don't forget, you have June 1st cuts, too.
That's exactly correct.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think they might make another splash. I wouldn't be surprised if they make a big splash. I wouldn't be surprised. Not at all. Because they could get that money for Love by the time they're, you know, in May. They could get that money for them. You know what I mean?
Right.
So, in my opinion, the next 2 years is their window before they're going to have to pay a lot of guys.
No, that's the reason I said yesterday, Gerard, that if they keep doing what they've been doing and they keep hitting on these draft choices, the window doesn't close, because all you do is once those guys come due, you can say, look, we've got guys behind you that we don't have to pay nearly as much money to. And I'm still going to go after another wide receiver in the draft. I'm going to still see if I can't find more weaponry. Go back to what you had when you had Jordy and you had Randall and you had Greg and you had Donald and you had James. I mean, and then Randall came in after that, and you had all these guys, including JerMichael Finley. I'd keep going. Just because you're fortified doesn't mean I would stop by any stretch of the imagination.
No, you have to take the best player available.
Yes.
You have to at this point. And what you're building now is just what you said. You're building depth for replacement depth. That's what you're building. And you got to keep on doing this. And like you said, he has to hit on four guys in this draft. That's what he has to hit on. We'll give him the benefit of the doubt. That's what he's going to have to hit on. With all the draft choices that he has, high draft choices, if he hits on four guys, I mean hits on four guys like he did last draft, then they're going to really, really be in a really good position. But I could see them adding another big name. I could see it, Bill. I really do. I got a funny feeling about that, you know?
Yep.
So I hope they do. And I tell you what, I wouldn't mind Hunter on one of the ends here. I wouldn't mind him. That's the guy I would look at.
Yep, so. No doubt. Good stuff, man.
Well, thanks, Bill.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.
There you go. Talk to you soon. That is our buddy Gerard joining us for a couple of minutes. Now, let's see here, because I was kind of surfing through the break there, and I did see that Matt Schneidman was the one that said that the Packers were asking Aaron Jones to take about a 50% pay cut. And so, again, you know, Aaron Jones tweeting out this morning, there's, you know, two or three sides to every story and yada, yada. Let me ask you this. And Grant, because you're the guy that takes a lot of this whenever they go to a rival, you take it more personal than I do. So if that's true and the Packers said take a 50% pay cut, are you mad at him for walking away?
So, well, there's layers to this. I could understand that Aaron Jones would be a little miffed by that. It's like, hey, look at the run I just had to end the season, right? You're asking me to take a 50% pay cut. That's very cold and businesslike. But I also assumed that Aaron Jones would have a better market than 1 year, $7 million,
right?
The Packers, in their estimation, they got the market right. The Packers said, we think you're worth around $6-7 million a year. That's what we want to pay you. And Jones said, screw you guys. And then he went and got that exact same number elsewhere. I guess that's why I'm miffed. And I understand Jones has every right to be frustrated, but to then go take basically the same amount of money with a rival, that's, if the Vikings gave him a pile of money, dude, cheers. Right? It's mm-hmm. the last big contract you're going to get, but that's not what happened.
Let's just say he said, I'm out. I'm not taking that kind of a pay cut. I'm willing to take some, but not that. I'm out. It just, you know, no. And they said, okay, that's fine. You're creeping up on 30. Clearly, if you, and again, I had somebody that actually just over on the live stream said, hey, I went back and watched that breakaway play against San Francisco. You're right. He should have taken it to the house and he didn't. So, okay. So he loses a step, 30 years old, loses a step. So they wanted younger and faster and a little more of a punishing running back that can actually take the beating a little bit better than what we've seen over Aaron Jones, even though Aaron Jones has never missed more than, you know, a handful of games his entire career for the season, because he's always played at least 11 games. So that being said, suppose he said, to hell with it, I'm out of, say, spite, and the only offer that rolls in, now remember, it's Drew Rosenhaus. So the only offer that rolls in that's substantial for a running back creeping up on the age of 30 is the Vikings, because they know him, because they've seen him so much. Do you then blame him?
This is tough, mm-hmm. right? The Packers are being cold in business, like Aaron Jones being cold in business. Like, look, put it this way. If this was John Runyon Jr. And he went to the Vikings for marginally more money,
you wouldn't care.
I get it. It's Mr. Packer Aaron Jones.
Right.
And that's why the council thing pissed me off. That's why this sucks so much.
Well,
I'll
say this, though. This wasn't Aaron Jones in the middle of the night finalizing a deal that nobody knew about to go to Minnesota. This is a guy that was told, take a 50% pay cut or more, otherwise talk to you later. And he said, no way. And not that much. And they said, okay, talk to you later. So a little bit different circumstance. But I get where you're coming from. But I'm trying to understand some of the angst that Packers fans, not just yourself, but Packers fans are kind of spewing both on the live stream and like via email and Twitter and such. To me, it's like, look, the guy he never did anything to besmirch the reputation of the Green Bay Packers. Nothing. He's been the absolute positive, perfect Packer. The only issue is he didn't retire a Packer. He's going to go somewhere else and wear another color, a color we don't like, at least associated to a team we don't like. And that's what I think has, because if he'd end up, again, just like Council going to the Cubs, if he'd have went anywhere else, we wouldn't have had a problem with it. But Council I mean, he doubled. He damn near doubled his money. Because remember, they were only offering him like 5.5. And he went down and said, talk to you later. I can make three, four more million down here. And they went, oh, okay, well, we're not going to match it. So, look, he did what he had to do. But this just seems like they went to the well maybe once too often for too large of a bucket of water for him to say, okay, I'll just swallow it and take it.
And by the way, council's way worse. The council going to the Cubs is way worse. There's levels, right? The Aaron Jones to the Vikings, that sucks. Council is worse. I'm not comparing the two, okay. But there are some parallels.
But I know you. I mean, I know you. I can almost, you and Chuck Freeman. Now, you don't throw things at your television. Chuck will beat the hell out of a bobblehead, throw it out the window, run out to the front yard, get it, pick it up, body slam in the body yard, bring it back in and throw it through his TV. You won't do that. I know that. But you both have that emotional, wah, you know, that upchuck of, you know, you're not our guy, you're their guy now. Emotion. Hey,
I'm a fan.
Yes. I don't like that. That's why we're so good at what we do, because we're passionate about it. Yeah. I get it.
Let me put it this way. I'm probably going to be a lot more aggressive 4-6 tonight than I am being on your show.
You can be aggressive. That's no problem. You can be aggressive. Yeah. There you go. And again, don't forget, he has been the team guy. He's, you know, restructured his deal numerous times. So it's not like this is the first time they came to him and he said, hell no. No, this was, I think, the third or fourth time they came to him. And this time it was much, much larger cut.
Probably plays a role in this too. This was probably a little bit of the straw that broke the camel's back. Yeah. I get why Aaron Jones is frustrated. I'm not frustrated that he left and went somewhere else. I'm frustrated that it was to a rival for like the same amount of money. It just seems needless to me.
The other thing, and Alex says over in the live stream, he says, don't forget all the guys that Goody has moved on from in the recent years have not been his guys. They were all drafted by Ted Thompson. That really doesn't matter because quality guys are quality guys. But I think Brian Gutekunst has a business approach and the same philosophy as Ted did. And that is, you know, you try to get younger, you try to get faster, you try to get cheaper. And when you're able to do so, it's better to cut a guy a year too early than a year too late. I would not doubt that Aaron Jones has a really good season this upcoming year, barring injury. And people are left to go, what the hell, you know? And then the following season is when you start to see the drop off. It's like for a running back, it is, there are some that are just special and they go beyond it. But for a running back in the National Football League, it is like once you hit the age of 30, you are then, for whatever reason, sprinting downhill. And unlike wide receivers, unlike, you know, defensive ends, you know, you can get savvy. Whereas a running back, it's all about speed, quickness, juke, movement. And it's like once you hit 30, it depends on how fast the ball rolls back downhill. It's just that simple. Let's do this. We're going to go ahead and take a quick break. We're going to come back. Got a lot more to get to. Got calls to get to as well. If you want to chime in, by all means, go ahead and give us a shout. This portion of the program brought to you by our friends at Point Brewing. And they have got something for everybody. You got the kids. They've got root beer. They've got the kiddie cocktails. You got the adult taste, but maybe still kid-like. They have the milkshake. The milkshake malt beer. Yeah, not kidding. They have that. They've got the Snow Pilot. Then there's their traditional lagers and such. And coming in the summertime, don't forget they have the IPAs and all the good blondes. And yeah, good stuff for the summertime brews. So all of that coming out from our friends over there at Point Brewing. Brewing excellence since 1857 in Stevens Point, Wisconsin.
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket. This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Make it a real Mad March with a playoff payout at Pottawatomie. Every week, you could score your share of 100 grand in cash and free play. Play this March for drawing entries. Win each Thursday. Plus, the prizes refresh every week for even more winners. The playoff payout at Pottawatomie, Milwaukee. It's anyone's game. For more details, visit paysbig.com/payout. Must be 21 and a club member to play.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes.
Yeah.
Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
The Bill Michaels Show continues on, and what a day it has been. Fast and furious in the world of NFL free agency, and the Packers have a place in it. They get Josh Jacobs. They get a little bit faster, younger, and a little bit more of a punishing back. They pick up Xavier McKinney to kind of solidify the secondary in that safety position. And they lose Aaron Jones, who then goes over to the Minnesota Vikings. Vikings lose Kirk Cousins, and the dominoes began to fall yesterday when Russell Wilson ends up signing with Pittsburgh. And to talk more about it, it's good to have him back, just if we're talking football in general. Our guy, Paul Charchian, joining us on the hotline. Charge, how you been, buddy?
Hey, buddy. I've been good. Well, I'm bittersweet. It's going to be weird to know that the Vikings are back to really just scrambling a quarterback like they have been for most of my adult life, where, you know, we'll be back to just hoping we can find the next guy in either a cast off that nobody wants like Sam Darnold or striking it rich in the draft. And that's been the general mode for the Vikings for most, most of my last 30 years. And now we're back to that. Your listeners do not have any concept of, idea of what that's like, but it's not a great place to be in.
So let's start off first and foremost with what, now we were talking a little bit earlier with Matt Collier, who covers the Purple Insider, and what do they do at quarterback? I mean, obviously they bring in Sam Darnold, but you got to think he's just a placeholder for whoever it is they go and get.
Yeah, that's the presumption is that Darnold is, they signed him to a $10 million one-year deal. No backup. 32 teams last year, none had a backup making $10 million. So, you know, they signed him to low-end starter money, I guess. I mean, maybe he's the starter. You know, the Vikings are, they're pick 11 in the draft. That's not a pathway to a quarterback. The top three guys are going to be gone, and now there's so much steam behind J.J. McCarthy, he may be gone as well before pick 11. And now, you know, the Vikings are going to be back to just, you know, throwing darts at Christian Ponder type guys and hoping one of them pans out.
So you get Aaron Jones. Does that do anything for excitement there?
A little. I mean, you know, signing a 29-year-old back is dicey, right? I mean, everybody knows that when the end comes for runners, it's severe, right? And last year, the Vikings got out of the Dalvin Cook business, and they did it just in time. I mean, there was nothing left, no tread on that tire, and they were right to get out of that business. So I asked myself, okay, The Packers know Aaron Jones better than anybody. Why didn't they want him back? Why did they decide that they wanted to go to Josh Jacobs? There's the, you know, the average age differential, certainly part of it. But I thought Aaron Jones played pretty well when he was healthy last year, but I just worry about investing in a 29-year-old back who's dinged up a lot. And that's been the story on Aaron Jones. Really good when he's healthy. And great guy from what I understand, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, everybody loves Aaron Jones.
Very much so, yeah.
Like, amazing locker room guy. Just, you know, one of those people that you just like to have associated with your team. But you know, I mean, I feel like when healthy, I'll be glad to have Aaron Jones. How much healthy play you're going to get out of him every year? It seems like a question mark. And that was, don't you feel like that's a fair assessment, Bill, based on your experience with Aaron Jones?
Very much. 100%. I couldn't agree. He doesn't have the same breakaway speed that he had, but certainly quick through the middle, very good at blitz pickup and recognition, and very sure-handed. He worked really, really hard when he got into the league at becoming a better receiver, so he's a good outlet out of the backfield. He's just got to be one thing, available. He does pretty much like Punxsutawney Phil coming up every year. You're always going to lose a few games because of an ankle injury or a hamstring injury. And if it nags for a long period of time, then you know how those things can be. So you kind of get what you know what you're getting in that sense. Let me ask you what you think of what the Packers did.
The Josh Jacobs part of it anyway?
Yeah.
Is that what you're referring to or other parts? Okay, Josh Jacobs. So has always been a workhorse back. He is a reasonably good blocker. He can catch better than I think people realize. And, you know, came off a bad year last year and kind of inexplicably so. He missed the four games last season. But, you know, look at the quarterback play they had. It was so bad. Now, I really feel like I'm ready to just say, okay, last year, 3.5 yards per carry, career worst mark. But just that offense was so broken, starting guys like Aiden O'Connell and benching Jimmy Garoppolo and just all the things that went wrong there. You know, I feel like you can just say, okay, we're going to put a line through that. The year before, he had 1,600 rushing yards. So, you know, you feel like he's still young enough to have some real bell cow to him. And A.J. Dillon was just, you know, it was clearly not working for him. So I like the move. They get younger. There was real need there. And you get a guy who's been, for the most part, very durable over the course of his career. So does it make sense? Yeah. You know, I think it does make sense for your team. And I think ultimately he'll be a strong element in that offense, and especially one that should be as balanced as that offense is going to be next year.
Now, we haven't gotten to the draft yet, and we're not done in free agency, obviously, but give me your thoughts on the hierarchy and the placement thereof, the NFC North right now. I mean, the one team that's been very quiet, obviously, has been Detroit. The Packers make a little bit of noise. Certainly Chicago still trying to get rid of Justin Fields, and they're not finding a lot of takers. But give me your thoughts on the hierarchy of the NFC North.
Well, Lions deserve to be number one based on where they finished last year, but it's close. It's a 1A and 1B with the Packers. You know, I do like that the Lions brought in Carlton Davis. Their back end needed help. And where they really needed help was their secondary. So they traded for Carlton Davis. That will help. Marcus Davenport signing doesn't do much for me. Guy's constantly hurt. And, you know, if he stays healthy, great. That'll be an unexpected boon for them. But, you know, it feels right now like it's a two-team race. Chicago's better than Vikings as well. And if Caleb Williams pans out at all. So I think the Bears were playing better ball than Minnesota at the end of the year. And with not knowing who the Vikings quarterback is, the Vikings are firmly in the cellar for where we are right now and what the projections would look like based, you know, pre-draft without knowing who the Vikings lined up at quarterback.
So what do the Vikings now need to do? I mean, you would assume they're going to find a quarterback in the draft in one way, shape or form, but what else do they have to kind of conquer, so to speak, to bring them back up?
Oh, so much. This team's got, it's got holes all over the place, unfortunately. And, you know, we're really suffering through a couple of different things. One was, you know, years of paying a lot of money to Kirk Cousins. And even this year, we're going to take a $27 million dead cap hit on him. And so all of that is certainly been, has certainly hurt the Vikings. But also, the 2 years we've had under new general manager, I guess not so new, heading into his third year now, Kwesi Adofo-Mensah, his moves have been almost universally bad, and we have so little young talent because the drafts have gone so badly for this team. And now this is now a team that rolls into the draft. They need quarterback. They need cornerback desperately. They don't have even one really starting grade cornerback. They need defensive end help. Danielle Hunter, the team made no move to sign Danielle Hunter, and they allocated about $100 million in different pieces for their defense. So Danielle Hunter's not going to be back. They still need a three technique. They need help at guard. This team still has a ton of holes. So there's still a lot of work to do for the Vikings, unfortunately, as they head into the draft. And and maybe now I think having spent as much money as they did at the linebacker position yesterday, I think that's probably most of the free agency moves that we're going to have right now.
When you look at what went down beginning yesterday anyway, who kind of won in your mind? Because you study not just your own backyard, but you study this more than anybody.
I'm not going to go straight to the Falcons with, the decision that they made to get Kirk Cousins. So I don't know that necessarily helped. Steelers, I mean, I don't like Russell Wilson, but to get him for free, that's a pretty good deal for the Steelers, a team that was a quarterback away from being pretty legitimate. And I liked that move for them quite a bit. Bengals helped themselves with Zach Moss and Austin Eckler going to Washington on a pretty friendly deal. I thought it was also a really nice move for them. I don't know. I mean, those are the things that jumped through day one that I feel like were really particularly good moves. And yeah, I don't know. We'll see. There are a handful that I didn't like. Didn't like the Jaguars. I didn't like signing Gabe Davis very much. Didn't like Saquon Barkley's deal. That's an expensive deal. Chicago muddies their backfield with DeAndre Swift, who didn't do much, and they gave him $24 million for a guy that clearly could not handle a bell cow role for Philadelphia. So, and then another really bad one that has NFC North elements to it. I mean, we all know Darnell Mooney's just a guy. We've seen him, go up against your Packers, my Vikings. $26 million deal and upwards of $26 million guaranteed, $39 million.
Right.
Wow. That is, that sounds like a bad deal to me. And as we know, you've been around this long enough, Phil. Two out of three of these free agent deals will not work out historically.
Right. And
most of the time, these things, the hit rate on these are pretty low in general.
Nope, completely agree. So the Green Bay Packers are on the rise, they believe. They've got a quarterback. Detroit's there. Minnesota's searching. The Bears are – now, do the Bears overtake the Minnesota Vikings at the bottom of the division, or does Minnesota hold tough?
Yeah. Assuming Caleb Williams is pretty good, yeah, I think they're in a far better position. That defense got so much better in the second half of last year, and particularly, after Thanksgiving. Boy, the Bears defense, had been so bad for so long, and it showed real signs of life. And, I think the Bears fans right now got to feel like they're closer. And by the way, let's remember, not only Caleb Williams, they get picked 9 in the draft.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's going to be an impact player as well. The Bears feel like they're in a really good spot to make some serious headway based on the improvement from last year and a presumed upgrade at quarterback.
Always good to talk to you, my buddy. I appreciate it. Hopefully you guys are doing well. Enjoy the summer. We got a lot of draft stuff to go over, and then we'll touch base again real soon, okay?
Let's talk closer to the draft. That'll be a lot of fun.
Absolutely. Good stuff. All right. Thanks, Charge.
Bye-bye, man.
See you, buddy. There you go. From Guillotine Leagues. GuillotineLeagues.com. He is the best fantasy draft guy out there, fantasy guy out there, and obviously from Minnesota and covers the Vikings as well. And Charge is just great stuff. Great stuff from Paul Charchian. So thanks to him for joining us today on this particular day as we talk about the between needs, so to speak, of both of these teams and the hierarchy that is the NFC North. Good stuff from our buddy Paul Charchian for a couple of minutes. Hey, this portion of the program brought to you by our friends over there at ABC Audio Video, whether it's a commercial, say you want to do a hotel, you want to do conference rooms, you want to do, theaters and such, or you want to do something like that in your own home and you want to do something, say, in your living room or a big theater room that you have surround, whatever it happens to be, Chris and the gang can do it. Go to ABC Audio Video anywhere. I've seen them do hospitals. I've seen them do small ballparks, some of the minor league parks around the area they've done stuff for. He's done stuff in my home. I trust him with my home, and he's the guy that I say, okay, I'll talk to you later. I'm leaving the house. No problems. He gets his work done, does his thing, and it's absolutely perfect when he comes. When I come back, he's just that good. That is my buddy Chris, ABC Audio Video, abcaudiovideo.com. Get a hold of Chris and the gang and get them on a schedule. They can come out and make make whatever it is you have like a world apart from what it is you have now. So get a hold of abcaudiovideo.com.
Ready? This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 5 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume. Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Thank you. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Good to have you back. The day after the flurry happened. By the way, the flurry is still continuing today. There's still, you know, Joe Mixon going to the Texans. Going to the Texans. Cincinnati giving up on their running back. And the Texans grabbing him up. So they're doing a deal there. Jalen Ramsey and the Dolphins restructured his contract. They save $19.9 million against the cap. So that going on as well. A lot of stuff happening throughout the NFL. This portion of the program brought to you by our friends at One Collision County Line, Menominee Falls. They did a fantastic job on my vehicle when I was hit in the rear end and had a little bit of a fender bender in the rear quarter and the rear bumper and such. And you can see there, if you're watching on the live stream, that's my vehicle. They did a terrific job. It looks like brand new. The gaps and everything, it seems perfect on that thing. They detailed it, gave it back to me. And the best part about it is you follow them via text messages every step of the way. So, and you always know about the time you're going to get your car back. So you can kind of plan on it. And they'll tell you, too, if there's some parts that are missing or that are needed, they'll handle it. So One Collision County Line in Menominee Falls, they're great, great people over there. 262-251-1700. They work great with the insurance companies, great with you regarding your deductible. Again, 262-251-1700, 262-251-1700. That is One Collision County Line over there in Menominee Falls, Wisconsin. Good stuff. Getting back at it, 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. If you want to give us a shout, please feel free to go ahead and do so. We would love to hear from you. A couple other areas that I think, going back to what Gerard said, going back to the top of the hour when Gerard called in, and he said he feels like there's another splash coming. If I had to take a guess, I would probably say, if there's a position that they probably want to bolster, I would say maybe middle linebacker. If there's somebody out there that the Packers would deem interesting to play alongside Quay Walker, to be solid, yet somewhat of a placeholder for whomever else it is they draft, probably would be a middle linebacker. I have not gotten too deep into the middle linebacking core as of right now. I mean, we can certainly do that. But just a couple of people asked me, what would be the next position you would target? I would probably target middle linebacker. That's probably where I would go. So it's, you know, if I'm thinking the Packers are going to go in a different direction of spending money, then that would be my next one. And let's be honest. I mean, you're pretty solid in certain areas, offensively speaking, and you don't have a desperation need right now other than depth. But you do need another starting linebacker. Could it end up being a guy like I? And I've said before, when everything went down in the drafting of Jordan Love that night, and the Green Bay Packers have made a trade, and with the pick, they are going to, and I thought this is it. They're going to get Patrick Queen because he was the best available linebacker coming out of LSU. He was a beast. And I thought this is the guy they're going to get. Wouldn't it be ironic if the guy that we thought they were going to draft, and instead they picked up Jordan Love. Now, 4 years later, 5 years later down the road, now he actually ends up joining the team if that guy as a free agent ends up coming into Green Bay. That would be a really solid pickup.
Go ahead. Well, I was just going to say the league is kind of telling us what they feel about this upcoming draft.
Right.
The fact that like Kenneth Murray is getting a bunch of money, linebackers like that, that's kind of the league, the team's way of saying we don't really love this upcoming linebacker class. So the Packers might be in a tough spot.
Yeah. Can Queen do what Devondre Campbell did when Devondre Campbell was earning the All-Pro status? No, he's not the same. He's not that same guy. But he has, his first year was good. His second year was not as good. He ended up getting banged up in his third. Last year, he had a really solid year. And this is, you know, now he's out trying to, you know, kind of capitalize on that a little bit. So we'll see. I mean, I don't know what his ceiling is or if he's reached that yet. But it did, has he had a Devondre Campbell-esque season so far when Devondre Campbell came over to the Green Bay Packers? No. So you kind of hope that now he's developed into that guy, that he does have it, but you're not certainly not going to crazy overpay for it, so to speak. By the way, Derrick Henry signing a two-year, $16 million deal with the Baltimore Ravens. Wow. Wow. Going to the Ravens. Going to the Ravens. So fully guaranteed $9 million out of that $16 million deal. It could end up being $20 million, depending on incentives. But Derrick Henry going to the Baltimore Ravens. Boy, you talk about the Ravens and the weaponry they have. Now, I would assume Odell Beckham Jr., who is a free agent now, there's a lot of indication he may be going back to L.A. He could go back and get reunited with Matthew Stafford again on another 1 or 2 year deal. But not, at least it appears as of right now, not going back to the Baltimore Ravens. But the Ravens, with a really solid year out of Lamar Jackson, who already went to an AFC championship game, the Ravens just got a whole lot better. And they've got that big beast grinder now that can get it done in the cold weather for the Baltimore Ravens. Derrick Henry going to the Ravens. Now, and I'll say this, Derrick Henry, when it comes to him being a running back, doesn't look like he's lost a step. Still a beast, still a load to bring down. That guy's a big dude. I don't care who you are. He's still got good wheels. So Derrick Henry, that's a good get for Baltimore. But Derrick Henry signing with the Baltimore Ravens. There you go. Brady says if they pick up Queen, the Packers have a lot of leverage in the draft to trade down and pick up a ton of needs right now in the offensive line, quarterback, and running back rooms. I am open to anybody, as long as they're best available. I would take two wide receivers in a heartbeat. I would take another tight end in a heartbeat. I would take offensive line. There is not a position on this team that I would not take, only for the fact that I think now you're really sitting, and I never say this because you don't want to relax. You never want to relax. But the overall makeup of this team, you're in a good spot. You're in a really good spot. And this one I wanted to go back to. This is from Jake. Jake says, what about the leadership qualities that Aaron Jones brought to this team? He seemed to be the guy that solidified other players around Jordan Love this past season. How much is that going to be missed? That's your million-dollar question. How much could, because we've seen what happens when you mess with chemistry. We've seen what happens when you mess with guys that are well-respected inside clubhouses and locker rooms. That they're kind of that straw, if you will, that stirs that drink. It can be an adjustment period. I think it's going to be incumbent upon both Josh Jacobs and Jordan Love. Jordan Love to be that leader now. He's been kind of handed the baton, you know, because Aaron Jones is not there. He's been handed the baton to say, you're the guy. You're the veteran. You're the leader now. It's not Aaron Jones anymore. You're the leader now. So he's probably going to reach out to Josh Jacobs at some point. Much like he and Aaron Jones and the wide receivers and such, they got together. You would expect Josh Jacobs to probably do the same thing, or at least you would hope that it would go in that direction. Get on the same page. Get on the same page as quickly as possible, because not only do you have to worry about the run game, which is your primary concern, but go back to the Mike McCarthy era in Green Bay. Your number one job, number one, was picking up blitzes. Because you knew they were going to throw the ball more than they were going to run it. So you had to understand blitz pickup. So picking up blitzes, the quarterback understanding his blind side and what your capabilities were and kind of that clock in his head. And then having the wherewithal on chip blocks to still be able to utilize you in a timing fashion as a wide receiver or a back coming out of the backfield that can be a check down. So that loss, that knowledgeable loss of Aaron Jones may be something that has to be prevalent when it comes to working things out with the running back position and Jordan Love. Let's do this. We'll step out. We'll take a quick break. We'll come back. We got a lot more to get to this portion of the program. Brought to you by our friends at Pottawatomie Hotel Casino. Pottawatomie Hotel Casino. They've got the Rockin' Brews. They've got the Dream Dance Steakhouse. They got Ryu. They have got the Street Eats. All of that over there under one roof. They've got the 360 Bar, the main, Canal Street Cafe, which is great for breakfast and meetings and such in the morning. The hotel, obviously, attached to it. Then there's gaming. Then there's slots and the big, beautiful new sports book. It's, you can almost smell the brand new sports book. It's almost ready. Maybe 5-6 weeks, something like that. And then that thing's going to open up, hopefully, knock on wood. And we're going to be there to christen that thing. That's Pottawatomie Hotel Casino. Go to paysbig.com. And you've got a lot of good opportunities if you are into the sports book thing over there at the kiosks and such, because March Madness is one of our favorite times of year just to throw a little bit down, you know, short of football season. There you go. So don't forget, Pottawatomie Hotel Casino. Go to paysbig.com to see what they have to offer. Paysbig.com.
This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Hey, if you're heading downtown, whether it's, you know, catching a game, Admirals game, Bucks game, concerts, Or once the Brewers get underway, you're going to go someplace after the ball game, head downtown, Calderon Club, the best Italian food you're ever going to stick right in your grill. Oh, my God, so good. Whether it's spaghetti meatballs, I love the spicy penne sashina. You've got the chicken marsala, which is out of this world. They've got the thin crust pizza, the eggplant that you can get for an appetizer, the bruschetta. Oh, both are just, I can go on and on and on. Then the next door, you want to go authentic. You want to go to Napoli, Italy, San Giorgio Pizzeria and Napoletana. It's right next door. Both places right next to one another, right across the street from the Hyatt, 838 Old World 3rd Street, downtown Milwaukee. You will not put better Italian food in your grill. I'm telling you, it's just fantastic. And Gino owns both places. Gino's a great guy. Great atmosphere, great people down there. The service is impeccable. Stop in, tell them we said hi, and you'll feel like family. That's the way they treat you. They're just really, really, really good people. Calderon Club on one side, San Giorgio on the other, 838 Old World 3rd Street, downtown Milwaukee. Good, good stuff. So Nick says the locker room was going to be different this year anyway. Definitely going to be new leadership more than before. Their expectations way higher than last year. And if they lose in the second round of the playoffs, they will be back entrenched right back in the same place. And then the pressure builds even more. There's always change in the locker room. Most NFL teams turn over about 25%. About 25% of the team usually turns over. That I agree with. However, when you lose large presence of leadership, that sometimes can be difficult because nobody just says, oh, you're the leader. You know, you can't get out of character. You know, you can't be something false or phony because guys will see right through that. So I still believe that the leadership void will be something that's going to have to kind of naturally fill itself in. Let's go to Mike listening to us in Eau Claire. Mike, welcome to the program, The Bill Michael Show.
Hey, Bill. Hey, I was thinking we were talking a little while ago about Patrick Queen, and I got the same story. I'm sitting at home. The Packers trade back up in the first round. I'm so excited, and I am very passive, very calm person, and it's the first time in my life I ever threw a remote control when I heard Jordan Love's name.
Right.
I thought for sure we were going to get Patrick Queen. We so much needed a linebacker. And I, like you, were hoping the same thing, but I think I heard he signed with the Seahawks this morning.
Did he sign with the Seahawks?
Maybe I'm
okay.
Wrong. I hope not.
I have to check.
Devin White.
Yeah, another name White? That's out there. Yeah, another name that's out there. Absolutely.
He gives us fits every time we play. I'd like to see him come to Green Bay.
Yep, that's another guy that would fill the bill. Devin White's got a little bit what I would consider to be a little more speed, so it wouldn't be terrible in that direction if they ended up going there. I wouldn't have a problem with it.
I'd like to see Patrick Queen. And just like you said, 4 years ago, I thought he was going to be a Packer. And it would be kind of neat if he came back and was a Packer.
Right.
I'd like that. But I'm not positive, but I think I heard he signed with Seattle.
I'll take a look because I got to let's see here. I'll take a look. When I get a chance, I'll take a look here at the top of the hour.
Okay. Hey, great show this morning. Appreciate your time.
No, appreciate it, man. Talk to you soon. There you go. The linebackers, Patrick Queen. It doesn't look like he has signed anywhere.
He's still available from everything that I see.
Yeah. Doesn't look like he signed anywhere. Maybe he talked to them. First of all, they have not been great at stopping the run. And he's good at kind of cleaning up the run game. He's decent at dropping into coverage, but that's where you would probably use more Quay Walker than anything. He's a good blitzer. In addition to the 133 tackles, he chipped in 3.5 sacks last year, 18 pressures. He hits a lot of the blitzes really hard, blows up guys and specifically running backs trying to fill the hole. And in that particular sense, and with an interception and 6 pass breakups, you know that he can produce in coverage as well, if need be. Albeit, you know, again, you can use Quay Walker for more of that if you choose to do so. So he's the guy that's still available, still out there. As to whether or not they go get him, well, that's a whole other thing. We'll have to wait and see if that actually happens or not. But it looks to me like Patrick Queen, still available, no doubt. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. 1670. If you want to find us, please feel free. Go ahead and do so. This is from Sterling. Sterling says, hey, unit, great show. I, too, would love to see Patrick Queen in green and gold. I thought he was going to be the guy that was going to be drafted years ago. And he says, and wouldn't that be ironic if indeed he does come back to the Green Bay Packers? I don't think he's better than Devondre Campbell, but I think at least he would be a good stopgap measure. And Sterling, appreciate the email. This is from Mike. Mike says, I think the Packers are on the right track. They're getting younger. They're getting faster. I still think they need to upgrade in the trenches, get a little more oomph. He has it. O-O-O-M-P-H. Get a little more oomph, and I think they'll be just fine. What do you think about getting bigger on the offensive line? You always talk about road graders and guys that can run block. Now you've got another legitimate running back who doesn't have to create for himself. Can the Packers get a little bit more staunch in the trenches? And that is from Mike. I think right now, I look at it this way, that they're fine. You can always get better, but that's not an area of major concern right now. What you would like to do is if you can upgrade at the tackle position, I think that would be the direction I'd go. But it's not like last year where you were coming in and kind of, you know, Elgton Jenkins coming off of the knee and then David Bakhtiari with the knee. And what were you going to do at the right tackle? Was it going to be Nyman? Was it going to be Tom? Was somebody else going to fill the bill? What was Runyon going to? I mean, you had a lot of different things moving. And last year it was kind of a mix and match throughout the season. This year going into the season anyway, you're pretty settled. So right now it's just about adding depth. And I would love to see them get, you know, some road graders. I wouldn't disagree with that. Hell no. Stay tuned. 2 hours down, 2 hours yet to go. More of the Bill Michael Show coming up right after this.
This is a Wisconsin Sports Zone update.
Well, the Packers going to be seeing Aaron Jones twice this fall. The day after releasing the third all-time leading rusher in franchise history, Green Bay saw the running back sign a one-year deal with the rival Minnesota Vikings. It's reportedly worth $7 million, which is about $1 million more than the 50% pay cut the Packers were reportedly asking Jones to take. The move comes in the wake of the Packers making a splash to the free agent market for the first time in several years. They're signing Raiders running back Josh Jacobs to a four-year deal, and they've grabbed one of the top safeties available in Giants Xavier McKinney. They've seen a number of their own free agents head elsewhere too. That included safety Darnell Savage going to the Jaguars, offensive lineman John Runyon Jr. going to the Giants. The free agent deals are able to be signed starting tomorrow afternoon when the new league year begins. Turning to Wisconsin, they're going to hold their annual pro day this Friday in Madison. It's a chance for the NFL hopeful guys to show their stuff to scouts from most of the league. Among those expected to work out include Braylon Allen, Mumajong Mehta, Tanner Mordecai, and Jason Maitre. The NFL draft going to be held in Detroit this year. Gets underway April 25th.
Mutual Assurance, keeping Wisconsin strong.
As a proud sponsor of the WIAA, Rural Mutual roots for all of Wisconsin's student athletes. Whether they're a hometown hero or they dream of the national spotlight, sportsmanship keeps Wisconsin strong. Visit ruralmutual.com/WIAA to learn more about how they support high school athletics.
Rural Mutual Assurance, keeping Wisconsin strong.
Well, the Bucks are in Sacramento. It's where they're going to close out their four-game road trip tonight against the Kings. Milwaukee 1-2 so far on the trip. The team has listed Chris Middleton as out once again. He has not played since February 6th due to a tonight is at 9, and the Wisconsin basketball team back on the court for practice today. They're going to face the winner of Rutgers and Maryland on Thursday in the Big Ten tournament. With this Wisconsin Sports Zone Network update, I'm Zach Heil, Print.
Good to have you back. Bill Michaels Show, this portion of the program brought to you by our friends at Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin. Go to PellaWI.com. That is Pella, WI.com, and they have the 0% interest for up to 60 months. And, you know, I love the windows and doors that I've had put in my home. You know that. I talk about them all the time, whether it's the safety, the economical factor, the value that's been added to my home, or just curb appeal. And they have many different styles and hardware and innovation and lines and such to fit your budget, fit your lifestyle. But I love mine. Absolutely love mine. Every time I go out of it, right when I take garbage downstairs and I got to, you know, quickly get out the door and right around the corner, I don't have to try to crank open that old aluminum door that I used to have. This thing, flip it up, flip the latch up, kick away the toe kicks, which is the safety device, and just slide it open with one finger. It's so good. So easy. I can do it with my elbow, too. My hands are full. It's great. Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin. Do not forget about them. And if you are doing a renovation, remodel, or a first construction, whatever it happens to be, go to Pella. Whether it's one window or a whole house full, they can help you out. Go to PellaWI.com. That is PellaWI.com. All right. We got, let's see here. Mike says, Skip Bayless says that cutting Jones would be a huge mistake. All right, look, I will say this. There's going to be a lot of speculation and a lot of conjecture until they actually get on the field and start to play. But, I will say this. I don't give two damns about what Skip Bayless has to say. He has been anti-Packer and so wrong for so long about so many things. I don't care, to be perfectly honest with you. Let's get back to the phone calls. Let's talk to John listening to us in Madison. John, what's going on, man? How you doing?
Bill, doing well. Beautiful Tuesday afternoon in the state of Wisconsin.
Yes.
60 and sunny, can't ask for more. Skip Bayless telling Packer fans today exactly how they should feel. And whatever he's saying, yeah, we should feel the opposite. That's the angle I'm kind of coming from. Bill, 2 years ago, the Lions were on Hard Knocks. Did you happen to catch that program?
I did catch some of it, yes.
Do you remember who the emotional leader of that team was throughout that whole preseason and through that season where they started real bad? The emotional leader really rallied.
Jamal Williams.
You might know this guy. And where was Jamal Williams this year?
Right. He moved on to New Orleans. Yes, you are correct.
And when he left the Packers, the concern was not necessarily on the field, because nobody's going to say, you know, when he was with the Packers, he was this elite caliber running back, right? But that's the concern we had. And I think that's the analogy that Packer fans, we just went through this. We're losing emotional leaders left and right, and the team continues to improve.
Mm-hmm.
So for the Packer fans today that are putting any value in the off-the-field production, you're misguided and you're sounding like Skip Bayless today.
No, let me say this.
Young leaders.
I agree with that, but let me say this. There is something to be said for somebody that gathered the locker room through the change of that quarterback from the that's going to be in the Hall of Fame to the new quarterback that they have. I'm not saying they're going to miss him. I'm saying it's going to take just a little longer time to work out who kind of emerges. So, because somebody emerges every year. Somebody comes up every year. All I'm saying is it'll take a little bit of an adjustment period. Not that they're going to be worse off.
Absolutely. And when Jamal Williams left Green Bay and went to the Lions, he immediately became the emotional leader. We got two absolute studs coming into Green Bay from other teams that are well in position to become emotional leaders. And to your point, they will find themselves. But, you know, when it comes to the nuts and bolts of how the NFL operates, man, Aaron Jones and his agent, they overvalued where he thought his market would be. They turned down, and then now they're ending up on a worse position for him, in my opinion, on a worse team. And you know, he just kind of got caught with his pants around his ankles, kind of reminded me of Melvin Gordon's situation when he ended his terms with the Chargers, right? You think your market's going to be big until you actually have to put the pen on the paper. And $7 million, I think that's going to be disappointing for Aaron Jones. And wish him well in, you know, Minnesota, except for 2 weeks we play. I have a feeling, though, man, the dark clouds are looming. I think Minnesota is going to make a pretty big move here at the most important position in football. And I hope to God it's not number 12.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Blooming for me.
No, I completely agree with that. Appreciate the phone call. Two things. One is, I think Aaron Jones will have a decent season this year. I think he will be one of their highlights. They still have Justin Jefferson. They still have the ability to go downfield now. They don't have anybody really to deliver the ball. I mean, Sam Darnold doesn't put a scare into anybody, I think, at this point. But the fact that they put him on turf, he's quicker on turf. We know that. He'll still be solid. He's still Aaron Jones. He's still the hard worker. The speculation about just strictly the pay cut, I don't think that was all of it. I just don't, because you're talking about a couple million bucks. So if he doesn't take 50%, so he takes 60%, or say he takes 40%. You're talking about a couple million bucks. I think it was more of, you're going to take this pay cut because we see the beginning of the decline of the breakaway speed. You're still vital to this team. And there still is, they were willing to pay him $6 to $7 million for that leadership. Okay. So he gets $1 million more. He goes somewhere else. Probably a little bit tired of taking the pay cuts. Okay. You know, I think we all understand that, but I don't sit here and criticize him for not taking the pay cut, not remaining a Packer. I think he just probably said, look, I've taken enough. At some point you got to pay me, you know? And he's made good money. Over the years, he's made good money over the years. He's not hurting. He won't be hurting for the rest of his life. So I just think it was, the Packers looked at it as, we're going to offer this. And this could be one of those offers where they know you're not going to take it. Say, hey, 50% pay cut. And if he's like, oh my God, there's no way I'm leaving Green Bay, and he takes it, well, then they get what they want. But if he says, and if they think he's not going to take it, then they're like, you made the decision to leave, not us. You know, because we've all been there for that, too. We've all been there for that, too. But I think he'll have a decent season this year. And then, you know, once you cross that finish line of 30, I think then you start to see the decline. But I don't. Look, you know, Bull says Aaron Jones is going to be forgotten like Craig Jennings. Come on, man. Really? The minute a guy doesn't take a pay cut, you just want to diss him? For everything he's done in the community, just all that's out the window. So let me ask you this, okay? Let me go down this path for a second. Then why do people talk at all about the quality of a person? This is what I'm talking about. So you want loyalty from the team, but the minute the guy doesn't say anything as far as taking his third or fourth pay cut, suddenly he's a son of a bitch and you want to kick him out the door. Is that what you're telling me? So why in the world would a player want to be loyal to you? Answer me that question. This is a business. They made a decision. He made a decision. Maybe he overvalued himself a little bit. Maybe that happened. But it kills me when all you want is loyalty, 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 loyalty. The minute a guy isn't really that good anymore, you are so ready to cut him and throw him out the door. It ain't funny. You're not loyal. You'll buy the jerseys. But the minute he's not good, the minute in some way, shape, or form you think he disses the organization by not taking his third pay cut, suddenly he's a son of a bitch and you want to kick him out the door. Oh, he'll be remembered like Craig Jennings. Come on. Come on, man. That's crap. 877-867-1670. 877-867-1670. If you want to find us, please feel free. Go ahead and give us a shout.
I also pointed out, we might have talked about this yesterday, but I definitely talked about it a lot last night, Bill. This is why we love the NFL. We love the NFL because teams are able to get rid of a bad contract. They're able to get rid of a player that no longer fits them. You can't do that in baseball or in basketball. It just sucks when it happens to one of your favorite players on your team.
Right.
Right. And I think we need to remember that. Like, this is why we love the NFL. It just sucks because it's impacting our favorite guy on our favorite
team. That's exactly it. You're mad, and you have a right to be mad. But don't put it this way. We hold ourselves in a certain light as Packers fans. Now, I'm talking as a fan. I'm not talking about what it is you and I do for a living. We hold ourselves in a certain light when it comes to being fans for three specific reasons. One is we are passionate about our teams. The second thing is we're more knowledgeable than a lot of fans that are out there. And the third thing is we consider ourselves a little more classy. So be classy. Don't be a jag. Don't be something what you despise. Don't be, go back to use Sam Weish when he grabbed the microphone and said, you don't live in Cleveland, you live in Cincinnati. You don't live in Chicago, you live in Wisconsin. You don't live in Minnesota, you live in Wisconsin. You know what I mean? Have a little more class. 877-867-1670. If you want to find us, that's a great way to do it. Again, 877-867-1670. This one's from Marty. Marty says, I wish Aaron Jones nothing but the best. He was very kind to my kids when I saw him at the softball game last year. It's a disappointing thing, the business of the NFL. I think that Aaron Jones is going to be okay, but I think Gutekunst did the right thing. It's all about business. Business is business. When it comes to your money, when it comes to getting younger, when it comes to getting faster, you have to do it in the NFL. Otherwise, standing still only means you're getting worse. I think this team needs upgrades in specific areas like middle linebacking, safety, secondary, and running back. And they did that at running back. They did that at safety. I look now for this team to get a better linebacker, to get a little bit better. To get a little bit better depth in the trenches and maybe find a receiver or two to complement what we have in Jordan Love. Jordan Love is a very good quarterback. Hopefully he will be again this year and for a very long time to come from a Packers fan who is passionate about his team. Thank you for the email. There you go. Good stuff. Good. I like it. Let's go to Alan listening to us in Milwaukee. Alan, how you doing today, man? What's going on?
Hey, Bill, long time no talk. Your comments are exactly what I was thinking. Loyalty goes both ways, okay? It goes from the fan, it goes to the player, but it goes to the organization as well. Mm-hmm. And God bless Aaron Jones. Oh, my goodness. He gave us so many memories. I just wish that he didn't go to the Vikings. That's the only thing. Any other team but the Vikings, I mean, I would love to see him twice a year, but it's hard. I know it's a business, and I wish him well. I was never towards the end a fan of Rodgers, but I still wish Rodgers well. I wish that he wouldn't have blown out his ACL so I could see him play. It's just hard, Bill, to see Jones go.
Like I said, if he appreciate the phone call, if he would have, you know, been cut and didn't take it and was still on the open market and going to another team elsewhere, I don't think anybody would say anything. You know, it's the Vikings, man. I get it. I get there's a passion there. You know what? Bull right there over on the live stream said, I'm sorry, I concur. There you go. So he takes back the comment. There you go. There you go. I like that. I like that when we can change minds. Sometimes, a lot of the time, you can change my mind. So I like that. I like that we're staying classy. Jason says, Bill, I personally love the Jacob signing. Jones couldn't stay healthy. And now you have a young back with 5 years in, three of his 5 years. He's been over 1,000 yards. And he's fast to complement our young, fast team. Let's do this, Packers fans. Be understanding and understanding the business. Have a good day. That's from Jason. Jason, you to me. You to me. Good stuff. This is real quick, going back to, you know, his discussion about seeing other players play. I got to be honest. I am anxious about a lot of things this year. I am anxious to see what Aaron Jones does over in Minneapolis. I am anxious to see Aaron Rodgers come back and play for the Jets. I am anxious. I'm anxious to see what the secondary is going to look like once the whole offseason culminates. I am anxious to see what the linebacking core is going to be. I'm anxious to see what Halfley's going to do with this defense. I really am. I'm anxious to see year two of Jordan Love. I love summertime. I love the fact that we're creeping into spring. I love the fact that on April 2nd, we are going to be live. We're going to be at Stenny's. It's going to be the Brewers' home opener. It is going to be passion. It's going to be baseball. It's going to be fun. We're going to have a great time. There's going to be wings. There's going to be beer. There's going to be shuttles going to the game, and baseball is going to be back. The boys of summer sitting on the patio, watching it outside, grilling out cigars, beers, everything. I'm anxious. But, damn, I love football season. Sometimes it can't get here fast enough because I'm excited now. I like that. I'm geeked up. 877-867-1670. Stick around. We got a lot more of the Bill Michaels Show. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back right after this.
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket, this is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
0% interest for up to 3 years at Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin. I'm Gina Della from Pella. Capella's free in-home consultations make replacing or redesigning your windows and doors easy. We go beyond just measuring and handing you a quote. We take the time to listen and educate you on all your product options. And with DesignWorks, you can see what your home will look like before you buy. Whether you're looking to replace your windows due to damage or it's time for a refresh and you'd like to revitalize your home style, choosing from Pella's wide range of windows and doors will complement your home's unique design. Pella can also customize, providing nearly endless possibilities for maximum design flexibility with dramatic sizes, custom colors, finishes, profiles, product types, and more. Order by March 31st to get 0% interest for up to 3 years. Set your free consultation at PellaWI.com.
Certain restrictions apply.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Yesterday, I did make it down to Robert's Specialty Meats down in Waukesha. I love that place. Love it. Went in, and Paul is stocking up. He said, hey, look, already getting people that are coming in and placing orders for opening day, whether it's the ribs on a stick, the garlic parm chicken skewers. He had a big load come in last night of king crabs. And you wouldn't think of the butcher shop in Waukesha as carrying the fresh king crabs, but he had those as well. So don't forget about seafood stuff. But if you're going to be doing a lot of tailgating, maybe you got a golf event coming up, a golf outing, and you need somebody on the course with catering and just kind of snacky stuff, they've got it. They've got so much good stuff down there, whether it's the high-end steaks or the garlic parm skewers. And they have a lot of crafted stuff, like stuffed chicken breasts and different flavors of sausages and the Al Capone roast, and which I ended up picking up that and some chicken breasts yesterday. And I love just, you know, grilling out. Just love it. It's what I do. Between that and smoking stuff, I just love it. So, and there's no better place to go. Robert's Specialty Meats in Waukesha. I'm blessed enough to have him within 10 minutes of my home. But he gets people that come from all over the state when they're going to games in, let's say, for American Family Field, or people from this area that are going to Lambeau or out to, you know, Camp Randall if you're going to do some tailgating, or just if you're in the area and you want to take something back with you. He does a lot of that stuff too, but check it out. They ship, they do all kinds of stuff. Robert's Specialty Meats, Waukesha.com. That's Robert's Specialty Meats, Waukesha.com on Sunset Drive in Waukesha. And tonight, I hope to get home in time, and I will be a happy guy because there is an Al Capone roast in my future. Damn well better believe it. 877-867-1670, 877-867-1670. Michael C. says, boy, by this time yesterday, there was all kinds of move. It's been very, very quiet, fairly quiet today so far. It has been. That I would agree with. It has been. Hey, coming up after the top of the hour, our buddy Peter Bukowski of the Locked On Packers podcast, we're going to talk with him about what he thinks and the direction the Packers are headed. So nothing huge coming out today regarding the the Packers, but you got a few moves that have happened today. You got Joe Mixon going down to the Texans. The Texans working out a deal there, so he leaves Cincinnati and he heads down to Houston. Apparently Josina Anderson is saying that cornerback Jameis Winston, he's going to go to an agreement with Cleveland. He still envisions himself as a starter. However, he says, the Lord has also called me to lead by impacting and increasing the men who are around me. So he wants to go work with Deshaun Watson and help him be the best he can possibly be. He said, and, you know, if God forbid Deshaun does not heal up or for whatever reason he can't take some snaps, then he's got Jameis Winston to back him up now. So it looks like Jameis Winston is going to end up in Cleveland backing up Deshaun Watson. So he is leaving, because he was backing up Derek Carr down in New Orleans. So he goes from Carr to Deshaun Watson in Cleveland. So another move being made. By the way, I did check, Patrick Queen not signed by anybody right now. Just to be sure, I went through the free agent tracker and nothing next to his name. Nothing at all. This is from Art. Art wants to know what Xavier McKinney brings to the table. Is he a big hitter or is he a speed guy? Well, he's a little of both. He's a versatile safety. He can kind of, you know, he's more of a slot cover guy than anything. It's not like he's going to run with the speedsters on the outside, but he can kind of hang with slot receivers via the post. And the fact that he has got some ball skills, this is a secondary, remember, that drops a lot of picks. He had 7 of them last year. They drop a lot of picks, and I should say 7 of them. He had 3 of them last season, and he has 9 picks and 14 pass breakups in his four seasons. So he had 3 picks last year. He's got better hands than a lot of the guys in the secondary, including corners, do. So he's only 26 years old. So I think between those two, getting Josh Jacobs to replace Aaron Jones, I like both moves. I'm excited about both moves. I think there's one more. I probably agree with Gerard. There's probably one more move out there. And that's probably going to be, you would assume, would be a linebacker. And then after that, I think the Packers are done, short of maybe whatever happens after June 1st. Because June 1st also, you're going to have cutdowns. June 1st because of salary cap ramifications. So guys get cut after June 1st. And then the Packers may be able to swoop in and get one, maybe two guys after that fact. But There's one more move. You kind of feel like with $30 million sitting there, $9 million, it's going to take you 9 to 10 to bring in all your rookies. That leaves you $20 million as it stands, just over $20 million, like $21 million right now, still available. Now, you're not going to blow it all. that you don't do that because you leave the Packers like to leave themselves anywhere between 10 and 15 million. So you probably have a minor deal left, but yeah, the Packers, they're not fans of running amok with money. They'll spend it when they have it, but like Brian Gutekunst said, we'll be in on every conversation. Doesn't necessarily we're going to, you know, do everything that everybody wants to do, but not a bad way to go right now. Not a bad position to be in. And what a difference. And I said this earlier in the week, what a difference a year makes. Last year, we're talking about salary cap restraints, $40 million of dead money. What are you going to do with David Bakhtiari if he can't play? How strapped are you going to be? You're not going to be that good of a team. You're barely going to make it into the postseason. You know, all that kind of stuff. If you get there, you know, trying to figure it out one season, try to get all this money off the books, just do something. And instead, they go on a roll. They demolish Dallas, which is another reason that Skip Bayless is pissed off. Let's go back to that for a second, because he was the one pontificating so boldly about the Packers being just brutalized by Dak Prescott, and Dak's going to get the win, and he's going to prove all the naysayers wrong, and yada, 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 only to watch him just cry in his beer, so to speak, metaphorically speaking. During that game on Twitter was like a double dose of euphoria. You know, every time you saw something happening, Dak throwing the pick six and the Packers running wild, Jones picking up first downs, just everything was flowing. The offense looked good. Not only was that pleasurable as a Packers fan, but then to see the ultimate of Skip Bayless just go down like the Titanic, mood and everything was just, that was a beautiful thing. It was just a beautiful thing. Is it bad, Grant, that I take so much pleasure in his pain in so many different levels?
No, I don't think it's bad. I also think he does it to himself. Like, he's just become such a caricature.
Yes.
He's like throwing his Cowboys jerseys in the trash. It's like, dude, you're a grown man. Like,
right.
Put the phone down. But that's what he does, right? Yes. That's why he's Skip Bayless.
Yep. Absolutely. That's 100%. I completely agree. This is from Troy. Troy says, hey, Unit, I'm a Packers fan, and I'm loving what's going on. I hate to see a guy like Aaron Jones leave our organization because he was such a class act, both on and off the field. But moving on, for better players is always a good thing. I think this team is now a true Super Bowl or bust team. Thoughts? Troy, it is hard for me to say Super Bowl. However, I think that they are one of the top 3 to 5 teams in the NFC. I think San Francisco is still there. I think Dallas is still there. Detroit is still there. What Philadelphia has done with bringing in Saquon Barkley, I really like it. Some of those deals don't work out there, so I'm kind of cautiously optimistic for Philadelphia. I think Philly can be there. I think the Packers are right there. God, who has gotten exponential? You know, the one thing about the Giants lose Saquon Barkley, but they quietly had a good day yesterday. They picked up some, they needed offensive line help and they got it. They needed a little defensive help and they got it. No splashy moves, but they got help where they needed it. I don't know what Daniel Jones is going to bring to the table, if anything. But I think although I hate the fact that they lost Saquon Barkley because he was their offense and they clearly paid the wrong guy, but I think some of the issues they've had, they bolstered. But I don't think they're going to leapfrog Philadelphia. I don't think they're going to leapfrog Dallas. I just don't.
I think two of the best days yesterday were maybe the Giants and the Vikings, but neither team has a quarterback, so
right.
It might not end up mattering at all if those two teams can't find their guy in the draft in a couple weeks.
Right. Yeah, I completely agree. I think they're kind of doing things correctly. I just, when you have the elusive quarterback that's still out there and you haven't necessarily solidified that position, it is so tough to have belief in those teams when they don't have that guy to lead them. And I completely agree with you. 877-867-1670. Don't go anywhere. Stay tuned. We got a whole lot more of the Bill Michael Show coming up. This portion of the program brought to you by every plumbing and heating, and they're in La Crosse, serving right in on Alaska more so than anything. Three generations, founded by a Korean War veteran in Clayton Every, passed along and passed along. Craig Every now running it, and they just hired some new plumbers. So if you're looking for a reconstruction, maybe a bath remodel, if you are doing something, say, like a water heater, water softening system, reverse osmosis, whatever it is, they can do that installation there as well. Or maybe you are one of those people that wake up in the morning and the floor is cold and you're like, man, I really want heat in the floor. They can do that. They can put heat in the garage. They can do that. There's plenty of things they can do. Check out our friends at Every Plumbing and Heating, serving the entire area, La Crosse, Trempealeau County, Monroe County, Vernon County, Jackson County, and based in Onalaska, Wisconsin, and hiring as we speak. Additional, they need more help because they're growing and they're getting bigger. 608-783-2803. 608-783-2803. Again, 608-783-2803. Every Plumbing and Heating out in La Crosse.
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket, this is the Bill Michael Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 5 minutes. Michaels will resume in 4 minutes. Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes.
Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Glad you're with us. Bill Michaels Show. On this sunny, warm Tuesday, I got to tell you, I got up during the commercial break, went over to the sliding door and opened the door. Got the sounds of outside now creeping in. I like that. Got the birds chirping a little bit. I mean, I don't think you can hear them, but it is a little breezy, but it is beautiful outside. There you go. If you're watching on a live stream, that's out the back window. Looking out of the window of the studio there, right there under the tiki bar. Yeah, can't wait. Later tonight, I'm going to be under that thing, grilling like a madman, even in the dark. Turn the lights on, be good to go. Going to be good. Pure Steel says, my biggest issue with Aaron Jones' situation is you obviously see where his priorities are. He'd rather seek revenge than compete for Super Bowls. Enjoy Sam Darnold. Thanks for the memories. Do you think that's what happened? Is that what happened, Grant, that he immediately picked up the phone and called the Vikings and wanted the revenge? Is that the perception that people are gathering, really?
Well, it happened rather quickly. I wouldn't fault the fan for reading the situation that way. I don't know. I would imagine the Vikings need running backs too, so the fit makes sense. It's not like fit is, you know, it's not like he's out of place there in a crowded running back room. He'll have opportunities to be the lead back, but it happened rather quickly. And as a Packers fan, I'm not going to begrudge anyone from thinking that maybe happened a little too quickly there.
I don't, look, Saquon Barkley was on the market for all of about a blink of an eye. Suddenly he was an Eagle. Josh Jacobs was on the market for a blink of an eye. Suddenly he was a Green Bay Packer. You know, I don't think it happened that way. I think they were maybe one of the... Look, if you're Drew Rosenhaus and you think your guy is... if you think your guy is getting ready to get cut, you're on the market. You're right away. You're out. And let's be honest. I mean, those that know you the best are your rivals. They face you twice a year. They know that. They understand that. David said, he overvalued himself and Green Bay signed Jacobs. It was too late. You're completely taking out of the fact, David, and everybody else that thinks this, they went younger. They went 4 years younger. They went more durable and breakaway speed. Everybody's completely glossing over that. Like, oh, by the way, they did get better. There wasn't this, hey, we were going to keep you and only you if you take a pay cut via 50% or less. It could have been one of two things. It could have been that was genuine, but we're going to get better. And it was maybe we're going to ask him to take a pay cut because we know he's not going to take it. You know, the Packers are trying to do their due diligence to get younger and faster. I don't see that in Aaron Jones. I just don't. I don't see him calling up right away, calling the Vikings, screw them, I'm going to the Vikings. I don't. Scott says, Scott says, simply amazing how many Green Bay Packers fans continue to let Minnesota live rent-free in their heads. And Pack fan says, did you see the contract deal? I saw that Matt Schneidman posted something about it, but I have not seen the specific breakdown. You're talking about for Aaron Jones?
Yeah, the difference in base pay was $2 million, I think, and I can pull it back up here. But essentially, the Packers were willing to pay him four base with $2 million in incentives, and the Vikings were willing to pay him six base with $1 million in incentives. So if you set the incentives aside, it was a difference of $2 million at the end of the day.
Okay. I don't really have any. Put it this way, he's taken pay cuts before. I don't think that was an issue. Do you think that was the big issue?
I bet he would have taken a pay cut. I mean, it was reported 50% they wanted him to take. This is more than 50% if you take out incentives, which I think you should, because if Aaron Jones gets hurt, right, those incentives aren't matched. So it was like 33%, really. It wasn't even 50% if you're just looking at base pay.
Yeah, the original deal was right around $12 million is what Aaron Jones would have made this year. I think it was $11 million or something like that, and then a million over that. So you say the final Green Bay offer was less than $4 million in base, but $2 million in incentives. So 3.8 or something like that. That could have ended up going to close to $6 million. The Vikings giving him a $6 million base with $1 million in incentives, which makes it $7 million. So totally, we're talking about a difference of a couple million dollars. However, it's still a big pay cut. You go from making $11 million in base to either $4 million a base or $6 million a base. Okay. It's still a big pay cut. You're still losing $4 or $5 million. I don't think he was on the phone with Minnesota at the time saying, for $2 million more, I'm coming there. I don't think that's it. I think it's the fact that he's slower. He's creeping up on 30. The Packers made a decision to move on. He could have still been there, but maybe he wouldn't have been the bell cow. A good two and a 1-2 punch. But also, let's be honest, the Packers offered him less. And my question to everybody is, if somebody tells you, we're not only going to tell you to take a 50% pay cut, your base pay is, we're talking millions of dollars less, and why are you mad at Aaron Jones for that? That's what I don't get. And if he undervalued or overvalued himself, he still ended up with more money from another team. So how is that undervaluing? Because if you would have taken a deal from the Green Bay Packers, he may still have hit the incentives and still ended up with close to the same amount of money. But if you get more money somewhere else, how is that undervaluing yourself? That's what I don't get. It's like, I really believe this. I really believe that people are looking for a reason to be pissed. Look, you got to be looking for a reason to be mad at him for not accepting the Packers deal. That's just, I don't understand it. And it's like you wish him nothing but the worst. Yeah, good luck with Sam Darnold. How luck? You know, it's like, are you stupid? He's still making $6 million. You can laugh on the way to the bank. You know, it just doesn't make sense to me why you would be upset. Not at all. Go ahead.
You know another issue, and I've seen certain smart football people point this out, is the way these contracts are structured. They're, you know, 4-year deals with all the money on the back end. So the total money, let's say it's $100 million deal, but like 50 million of that is the last 2 years split 25 and 25. And only the first 2 years are guaranteed.
Right.
So what ends up happening is this player gets to year three or year four and the team is like, yeah, we're not actually going to pay you that, but we inflated that number. We make the contract look nice. Right. So your agent can parade it around. It's like you're making $100 million. But then you get to the back end of that deal and you either need to restructure or you need to take a pay cut.
Right.
That's a really sticky spot to be in, because the team and the player, they sign these deals knowing damn well those final years aren't going to play out at that number.
And here's the other thing that I think is ironic. He took a pay cut last year. He took a restructure last year, if I'm not mistaken. And people say, well, good luck with that, you know, winning Super Bowls, you know, over your money. Well, he took a pay cut last year to stay here. He didn't have to do that. He could have said, no, we're not doing it. Could have forced his way out last year. He could have forced his way out when Aaron Rodgers was here and things weren't good. After that last season with Rodgers. That's what I'm saying. He's taken restructures before. It's kind of a moot point. You know? So, but yeah, most contracts, it's all about the guaranteed money. That's what the contracts are. It's all about the guaranteed money. So, like Kirk Cousins signs for 100 and whatever it was, million dollars yesterday, but 50 million of it's guaranteed. 50 million of it's guaranteed. I think it was 100. What was the total deal? I think 130 million or something like that. But out of that, like 100 million of that, 50 million signing, and then there's like 50 million of that's guaranteed. The rest of it is not totally guaranteed. So, yeah, I mean, they've been doing that for a long time. That's the reason you look at a guy like Bakhtiari. The contract would have called for much, much more money to be paid to him, but the only part that they had to pay him on the way out the door was the guaranteed money. And it's just been, that's the way football is. So you can sign a five-year, $500 million contract, but if only $60 million of it's guaranteed, they're going to write the deal to where it's backloaded, and you may never see the totality of that money. Now, the leverage you have is they're going to owe you a lot of money, and if you play well enough, then they can continue to restructure that deal, and you get more and more of that money. They'll convert it into signing bonus, and you can get more and more of that money. Otherwise, it doesn't behoove the player to do anything to even come close to signing that deal. 877-867-1670. There's contracts in the National Football League, there's a ton of semantics, and I completely agree with you. Stay tuned. More of the Bill Michaels Show is next.
Covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket, this is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
0% interest for up to 3 years at Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin. I'm Gina Della from Pella. Pella's free in-home consultations make replacing or redesigning your windows and doors easy. We go beyond just measuring and handing you a quote. We take the time to listen and educate you on all your product options. And with Design Works, you can see what your home will look like before you buy. Whether you're looking to replace your windows due to damage or it's time for a refresh and you'd like to revitalize your home style, choosing from Pella's wide range of windows and doors will complement your home's unique design. Pella can also customize, providing nearly endless possibilities for maximum design flexibility with dramatic sizes, custom colors, finishes, profiles, product types, and more. Order by March 31st to get 0% interest for up to 3 years. Set your free consultation at PellaWI.com.
Certain restrictions apply.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes. Michaels will resume in 2 minutes. We'll be right back.
Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute. Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Remind you, coming up on opening day, the Brewers home opener. Can't wait. Looking forward to it. I mean, I know I'm geeked up for football right now, but we're going to be at Stenny's, second of National, Walker's Point down there with the opening day broadcast. The Brewers are going to be back at home taking on the Minnesota Twins Tuesday, April 2nd. We will see you down there. Show will get underway. Doors are going to open. Bloody Marys are flowing. Beverages are flowing. Garlic cheese bread and wings for everybody. Oh, it's going to be a good time. Chuck Freeman from the Locked On Pack or the Locked On Brewers podcast is going to be joining me. We got our usual band of fun people, including Kevin Holden from CBS 58 and Deportes, who is going to be down there as well. Always joins us. And it's our fourth straight year down at Stenny's, getting you ready. And the best part about it is you can come to Stenny's, enjoy yourself, and then catch the shuttle. Let them do the driving. Catch the shuttle over to American Family Field. Check out the Brewers and let them drive you back. It's that simple. And that way you don't have to pay to park and all that kind of crazy stuff. And you can still walk around, enjoy the fun and frivolity that is the parking lot and everything prior to. And then still let them bring you back. Good way to go. That's our friends at Stenny's. Second of National, Walker's Point. We're going to be down there with the opening day broadcast. Fourth year in a row we're going to be there as the Brewers open up against the Minnesota Twins on Tuesday, April 2nd. We hope to see you there as a face in the crowd. It's going to be a lot of fun. Coming up after the top of the hour, Peter Bukowski of the Locked On Packers podcast. He's going to be joining us, and we'll talk with him about what he thinks the state of the Packers is now. So we're looking forward to that conversation coming up here in just a short bit. Also, I wanted to remind you, coming up tonight, that we are going to be paying attention. You got the Bucks taking on Sacramento tonight, but also tonight, 6 o'clock, you have got the UWM Panthers. They're going to be taking on Oakland, and they're playing in the finals of the Horizon League tournament. They win tonight. They're in the big dance. So excited about that. So, I mean, I know for a while we were kind of talking about the UW Green Bay and the Phoenix possibly making it in, and they, you know, hit a couple of roadblocks down the stretch, but nevertheless, a hell of a season for the Phoenix. But if UWM gets the win tonight, they're on their way to dancing with everybody. So it'll be exciting. It'll be fun. So I'm kind of going to pay attention to that tonight too, watching that game and rooting for UWM and the Panthers getting back into the tournament. They haven't been in the tournament in a decade. So it'd be great to get them back in. You know, you're going to have Marquette there. Most likely Wisconsin's going to be there as well. So we got some good hoops going on throughout the state of Wisconsin. And then obviously the Milwaukee Bucks. So there you go. There you go. This is from Al. Al says, I like the direction that the Packers are going. Brian Gutekunst made a tough call. He's going to take some heat for it, but if you get younger and faster and a little bit cheaper, that's the way to go, and that's the way you build a championship. He gets one more good draft under his belt, and in 2 years, this team should be knocking at the door of wherever the Super Bowl will be. Appreciate the email. By the way, the Super Bowl at that period of time will be in the backyard of the San Francisco 49ers. It will be at Levi Stadium. So this coming year, New Orleans is where we're going to be. And then in a couple of years, it's going to be at Levi Stadium. And then in 3 years, it'll be back at SoFi Stadium back in California. I can't stand California Super Bowls, but nevertheless, the Packers are in it. We're all going to be there, right? No doubt. Anthony says, even when Aaron Jones was healthy, the Packers were not willing to give him the 20 plus carries a game. I think they'd rather pay a guy that can give you a lot of carries for the same-ish money. They just use that goof. And the whole thing with A.J. Dillon, that people say, well, now you can keep Dillon. Can I ask you why? I'd like to know why. What attractiveness is there about keeping A.J. Dillon? For those that were screaming about that earlier this morning. And it wasn't a lot, but there was a vocal minority. And my question would be, why? What dynamicness does he bring to the table? Because he has big quads, Bill. Duh. That's from Kyle. Kyle, I have big quads, and you're not bringing me onto the Green Bay Packers organization. I'll tell you that right now.
I'd say it's because he hasn't been on our TV in a while, and we forgot how slow and just right? Not electric and not dynamic he was this year.
The, quote, mayor of Door County, is that the reason? That, you know, look, he was a good ambassador for Door County, certainly, but as far as good guys in the community, Aaron Jones has done more. So you're not keeping a guy around like that that doesn't have a higher level of productivity just because you like him, you know?
Little breaking news, Bill, before we break and get to Pete. Patrick Queen has signed with the Steelers.
Wow.
That's juicy.
Wow.
41 million bucks.
You talk about bolstering. Oh, boy. In the division. He goes through a division rival. Wow. Well, was nice. The nice dream was there while it lasted. That was about it. Patrick Queen going to the Steelers, the Steel Curtain, playing along with TJ Watt. Oh, man. They just bolstered their defense. Stay tuned. More of the Bill Michaels Show yet to come. Another hour. Peter Bukowski, Locked On Packers podcast, next.
Is a Wisconsin Sports Zone update.
Well, the Packers going to be seeing Aaron Jones twice this fall. The day after releasing the third all-time leading rusher in franchise history, Green Bay saw the running back sign a one-year deal with the rival Minnesota Vikings. It's reportedly worth $7 million, which is about a million more than the 50% pay cut the Packers were reportedly asking Jones to take. The move comes in the wake of the Packers making a splash in the free agent market for the first time in several years. They're signing Raiders running back Josh Jacobs to a four-year deal, and they've grabbed one of the top safeties available in Giants Xavier McKinney. They've seen a number of their own free agents head elsewhere too. That included safety Darnell Savage going to the Jaguars, offensive lineman John Runyon Jr. going to the Giants. The free agent deals are able to be signed starting tomorrow afternoon when the new league year begins. Turning to Wisconsin, they're going to hold their annual pro day this Friday in Madison. It's a chance for the NFL hopeful guys to show their stuff to scouts from most of the league. Among those expected to work out include Braylon Allen, Mumajong Mehta, Tanner Mordecai, and Jason Maitre. The NFL draft going to be held in Detroit this year. It gets underway April 25th.
Rural Mutual is the number one farm insurer in Wisconsin for a good reason. As a company founded by farmers, they understand the ag industry and its challenges. Local agents offer farm families the best advice and personalized coverage. Visit ruralmutual.com to find an agent near you. Rural Mutual Insurance, keeping
Wisconsin strong. Well, the Bucks are in Sacramento. It's where they're going to close out their four-game road trip tonight against the Kings. Milwaukee 1-2 so far on the trip. The team has listed Chris Middleton as out once again. He has not played since February 6th due to a sprained ankle. Tip tonight is at 9, and the Wisconsin basketball team back on the court for practice today. They're going to face the winner of Rutgers and Maryland on Thursday in the Big Ten tournament. With this Wisconsin Sports Zone Network update, I'm Zach Heil.
Good to have you back, the Bill Michaels Show. Got a lot of stuff going on. So Patrick Queen signs with the Steelers. The Packers' former running back Aaron Jones goes over to the Vikings. The Texans and the Bengals make a deal, and Joe Mixon and now becomes a Texan. In the meantime, the Ravens, who lost Patrick Queen, but they picked up the running back Derrick Henry, and then Jameis Winston goes to the Browns to back up Deshaun Watson. So you got a lot of movement, even though it's not major today, but nevertheless. The Ravens, by the way, 2 years, a $16 million agreement with Derrick Henry. 2 years, $16 million for Derrick Henry. So there you go in that regard. And in the meantime, the Packers pick up McKinney in the secondary, Josh Jacobs, to run the football. And to talk more about it, Peter Bukowski from the Locked On Packers podcast joining us on the hotline. Pete, how you doing, bud?
I am trying to recover from yesterday. I still got a little vertigo from the roller coaster ride that we were on, but I'm excited to talk about it with you.
Well, let's start with Aaron Jones. So, you know, because there are a handful of fans that are all pissed off. And how did he not take a bigger pay cut to remain with a Packer and yada, yada, yada. So give me your thoughts there.
Well, it's not up to the player to take the pay cut. Let's just first and foremost. Like, it's different with Green Bay because they don't have an owner. But I think you, to any of those fans, I always want to say, who would you rather have the money, the players or the billionaire that owns the team? I'd always rather the player have the money. They're the ones putting their bodies on the line. So I'm never going to begrudge a player from saying, I'm going to take more money. I think this instance is particularly interesting because we have the report from The Athletic and we got the specific contract numbers now that the Vikings, that deal was six plus $1 million in incentives. So a total of seven. And the Packers offer was four with $2 million in incentives. And you can say, okay, well, it ends up being just $1 million difference, except it doesn't because the original deal was over 11. And so you're having to reduce that base salary again, a lot. And I can understand from an Aaron Jones standpoint of just being like, look, I'm not doing it again. You signed me to a contract. Yes. One that, you know, I should have known was probably not going to be real, but to ask a pay cut of this degree, it's just too much. And apparently they countered and the Packers just said, thanks, but no thanks. And they moved on. They decided they'd rather have Josh Jacobs. And I think that's the thing that we need to understand here is the Packers seem to have been the team that said, we're not going to negotiate beyond X. So there's no more talk. You didn't want the deal we offered. And so we moved on. And I think that is where we need to land in terms of trying to have productive conversations about Aaron Jones's motivations and all of this.
So, and look, I get it. It's a business. They're trying to get younger. They're trying to get faster. They did offer Aaron Jones the opportunity to stay. I'm sure he's probably kind of at the end of his rope as far as restructures go. He did want to stay, but not for the amount of money that they were trying to kind of get him down to. So, look, you move on. You feel like you got better. You feel like you got a little more durable. You got a little bit faster. You got a little bit younger. So you're good, yeah, as far as the Green Bay Packers go in that regard. Now, the secondary was an area of concern when it comes to the safety position, obviously. Give me your thoughts on McKinney, because I think this is a hell of a deal. And the fact that you've got a guy that can cover the slot, the guy, he's probably now automatically got the best hands in the secondary just because he had three picks coming off of last season. And he can pick up the run and more so than anything, he can blitz and he can get through on blitzes too.
Yeah, you want a versatile player, Xavier McKinney is it. I mean, he can play in the slot. He probably walks in as the guy where I would go, if you told me he was just going to play slot, cool. He can play in the slot. He can play deep middle. He can play deep half. He can play overhang. He can play anywhere on your defense that you want him to play. And when we heard Jeff Hafley explain exactly what he wanted from a post safety, Xavier McKinney, not the prototype in terms of the speed. You know, he's a 4.6 guy. But the instincts, the playmaking, and then the versatility. He can cover tight ends one-on-one. Like there's tape of him just like Mike Gesicki, one of the most athletic tight ends in the league, sticking with him from the slot, carrying receivers vertically, filling the run from deep. Yeah, $17 million is a lot, but it's probably not going to be $17 million. It's something like $25 in the first year. So we're looking at really a one-year, and then we'll see 2 years probably because of the dead money. But 2 years and then we'll see is every contract the Packers sign. And it works out pretty well for them by and large. When they don't have to kick money down the road because of restructuring, because of COVID spikes, and that was a problem there. They seem to make this work pretty well consistently. So this is a no-brainer. You're paying him at the top of the market, and that can be tricky, but he has the potential. He's 24, Bill. Mm-hmm. He turns 25 in August. Like, that is, to get a player that has played this well, he's Pro Football Focus's number one graded safety since 2019 when he lines up at free safety. The number one free safety in the league going back three seasons. So, or four seasons. So basically since he entered the league, when he's played free safety, he's been the best cover player in the league. That is the kind of player that Brian Gutekunst loves to bet on. Give me a young player with pedigree, Alabama ties. Derek Ainsley, the new passing game coordinator, recruited him out of Alabama. And so this is someone who can come in and be not just like Adrian Amos solid, no, an impact difference maker field filter for them.
So what's left? I mean, we were talking earlier about maybe there's another move, another, arrow in the quiver that they may fire. Is it a middle linebacker at this point? I mean, Patrick Queen just came off the board, but is there a middle linebacker that you would covet? Or do you think you just kind of wait for the June 1st cutdowns and maybe there's somebody else that's going to be out there?
Yeah, I think that it depends on what the market is showing us. Now, what's interesting, Jordan Brooks got about $10 million APY in the deal that he signed to leave Seattle. Patrick Queen only got less than $14 million a year. Jerome Baker is a linebacker from Miami, to me, who makes all the sense in the world for the Packers. Was someone who coached under new linebackers coach and or played under Anthony Campanile, the new linebackers coach. A former Ohio State guy. So Bill Hafley used to know everyone that played at Ohio State in the last 10 years, whether they were there when he was there or not. And he's exactly the kind of player, a steady, consistent guy. He's graded in the top 30 by Pro Football Focus basically every year that he's been a meaningful player in Miami, except for last year when you're running a new, different kind of defense. I think that's something that would make sense and at cost. I think there's another safety. And they don't have to rush on them. You see what the draft brings. If you made your big splash here, that's the guy that has to make your defense work. That's Xavier McKinney. See what you can find in the draft. And there's always going to be, there's safeties in the couch cushions in June every year. The Tayshawn Gibsons, who played for Jeff Hafley in Cleveland and was solid in San Francisco last year, those guys are going to be available in June, July. I don't think you have to rush into anything here. Getting your running back, now your bell cow back, such that those exist in the NFL now, and that post safety. It just means that now they can value hunt if they want to. They've got enough money that if they want to sign another middle-class free agent, they can, and still get into the bargain bin of the safety position later. Someone like Kenny Moore, the tight end, was the first guy that I saw mention that, one of the best slot corners in the league. I think that would now the whole spine of your defense has changed. If you had Kenny Moore and David McKinney in one offseason, you might be able to check corner off of your list. If you want to, and then go in and just like offensive line and add another pass rusher and do all kinds of cool stuff in the draft. There's certainly some tweaks that can be made, but the moves that they've already made, I think sets them up really, really well to find good value here moving forward. You pay to the top of the market for two positions. Now you can sit back and be reactive rather than proactive.
I first of all, I love what they've done, and I agree with you. So do you think then that there could, because they're sitting on what, about $31 million, I think, right now, if I'm not mistaken. And, you figure about $10 million for the draft choices and such that are coming in, which is going to leave you with about 20. And they like to always hang on to between 13 and 15 million bucks just in case. So that gives you like about 7 to 10 million in that realm to be able to play with a little bit. Do you think there one, two things? One, there's a restructure that could possibly happen still down the road. Or two, do you think that there is somebody, there's another move that they're going to make? Does it feel like there's another move they're going to make?
I think there's something else coming. And I think that they've been working on a lot of things over the last couple of weeks. And so I just, maybe they're done. I don't think they are. And they do, as you said, want to give themselves some room for money here, but they also, the Jordan Love extension, they're clearing in June, Devondre Campbell's $10.5 million, and they have a Kenny Clark extension they could sign if they wanted to. Now the defensive tackle market has exploded. Unfortunately, this may be the last year we see Kenny Clark in Green Bay, just given what it costs, for someone at that position. But if they wanted to do an extension, they could. And then, you know, that could reduce his cap number as well, give them a little bit more money to play with. Also, Bill, remember, Brian Gutekunst has, in a couple of instances, talked about wanting to, or at least having the ability to, use their draft picks to make trades. I don't think that's out of the question here, that they get into the trade market here at some point with a player that they like, whether it's a linebacker, whether it's a pass rusher, whether it's, you know, maybe a skill position player. I think that's still on the table for them as well. Use the cap space that way.
Here's another question when it comes to the trade possibility. I mean, I know Brian Gutekunst, you know, likes to use a little bit of that capital if he can. But do you think that's more likely to happen prior to the draft? Or do you think that they start trading away future draft choices once they get to the day of the draft?
No, I think it's more likely to be something that you do closer to the draft. Or you could do it now if you're going to trade, okay, here's a third round pick for this guy. Okay, well, we know where that pick is.
Right.
I see it as less likely on the day of the draft when it's the Packers sending picks out for players. That seems less likely to me. But we'll see. That would be a change, certainly, from the way that they've operated in the past. Now, could they make a trade for more draft picks? Certainly, I think that's in play as well. But they have so many picks right now and mm-hmm. a roster that doesn't necessarily need all of those picks. That's why I've got my eye sort of like, okay, who could they be going after? A second round pick, a third round pick? What could they see shake loose? Maybe they try and sneak into the Legarius Sneed trade stuff late. I mean, like, Brian Burns is going for a second and a fifth. If that's all you can get for a premier player who you've got to pay, then, I mean, why not at least call the Chiefs to do what you can do there?
Right. Yeah, and I agree with you, because let's say the Packers do have a spectacular season, then the value of their draft choices, unless it's already a placed choice, begins to fall in the draft anyway. So I completely agree there. What else? What are you targeting in the draft? What's heavy that you like that you looked at and said, okay, some of these guys, some of these positions are going to be fortified via the Green Bay Packers in the draft?
I think as much as it is not going to be sexy, Bill, at least to some people, this at the top especially – is an outstanding offensive line draft. So you want to get a guy that can compete to be your franchise left tackle. Rashid Walker has a great season in second year, takes a big step forward. But remember, in the beginning of that season, he's splitting time with Yash Nyman. And ended up strong, but like, if you could get a Tyler Guyton from Oklahoma or a Troy Fautanu from Washington, who could be a guard for them, Bram Barton, the tackle from Duke, could be a guard or a center for them. There's some interior offensive line. Look at the market for interior offensive linemen. John Renee Jr. goes to New York and gets $10 million a year.
Right.
Robert Hunt gets an absolutely massive deal to play guard. Like, these are not premier players. And the reason they're getting paid is because right now, the interior, guys like Christian Wilkins and Eric Armstead, who just got cut by San Francisco, but this interior pass rush is the most devastating thing. Look at the Chris Jones that you can have right now. And there aren't enough guys to block them. And so this is a draft if you're the Packers. Fautanu, Graham Barton. There are some centers that I really like in this draft as well on day two, potentially. Their first top 30 visit was just reported as the guard from Michigan. So I think that is a place where they can look to add. Sean Ryan is an ascending player, I think. But this is where you could really make some money for the Packers. 28-41, they might double dip at offensive line in this one, and there could be two legit first-round talents there.
Talking with Peter Bukowski, co-founder of The Leap and the Locked On Packers podcast, joining us on the hotline. Reading the story about Aaron Jones and Drew Rosenhaus, they just, you know, the Packers offered them a certain amount of cut, and they just weren't willing to accept it. It wasn't that they weren't willing to take a pay cut. It was just they didn't want to get cut that much, and all of a sudden things really began to deteriorate. Why do you think the Packers cut them to, you know, less than or more than 50%?
Well, I think they correctly gauged the market, don't you? I mean, they offered him six total, and the Vikings offered him seven total. They basically hit the market. And the question is, okay, it's guaranteed base salary versus, you know, incentives. So I think that they said, this is what we think the market is going to bear out for you, and this is how we think we want to structure it. And the reason you structure it the way that they decided to, in their final offer with the incentives, was look at how many games he played this season. And beyond the games, how many games was he 100%? Like seven mm-hmm. out of 17? That's just not enough. And so even if you're getting, you know, 13 or 14 from Josh Jacobs, you're going to get 13 or 14 every year from Josh Jacobs. And that's just not something you could say about Aaron Jones. And it feels, you know, kind of gross, I know, from a Packers perspective, to like talk in critical terms about Aaron Jones, especially now that he's gone, and especially because he seems to be pretty miffed about how this was all handled. But I understand the Packers wanting to protect themselves and say, look, you didn't play a lot last year. Yeah, you were great when you played, but the whole offense kind of fell apart when you weren't out there, and we can't countenance that anymore. And so it's got to be an incentive-filled deal. Maybe it would have been fine if you'd have said, okay, it's $3 million in total incentives. Like, I don't know if you're really changing anyone's life from a Packers perspective with $1 million difference. But I will say this too, Bill, for the Packers fans saying, well, it's just $1 million is a lot of money to a lot of people, to most people. Wouldn't you want the extra million? And to that I say, yes, except it's $500K after tax, and you're going to spend the rest on lawyers and broker fees buying a new house in Minnesota. Like, it is net negative money for Aaron Jones in terms of what he's missing out on. So he's going to Minnesota to prove a point. And because that was all the market bears out. Anytime you hear an athlete say, oh, I took less to go to this place, do not believe them. That is almost always absolute nonsense.
I would agree with that. And you kind of wonder what his value is going to be after a year running in Minnesota, you know, behind Sam Darnold. Now, granted, you have Justin Jefferson and the offensive line is adequate at best, but Sam Darnold's not going to be a guy that's going to move the ball consistently up and down the field. You kind of wonder where he's going to be, unless all of a sudden he becomes the bell cow and faster on that turf, that suddenly he can kind of show his wares and maybe there's going to be more money. Because also, the running back market got saturated very quickly. Derrick Henry, Saquon Barkley, and numerous running backs suddenly on the open market. Suddenly the price went down for a lot of them. It was higher for some, but not as high for all. And maybe he ends up making a little more money. But once you get on the other side of 30, man, you know as well as I do, that ball rolls downhill really, really fast.
I mean, listen, the 30-year-old track record of post-30 running backs in the league is essentially nothing unless you're Adrian Peterson or Emmitt Smith. And so, you know, God bless Aaron Jones. He keeps his body in really good shape. He was great when he was healthy last year. But again, One of the things that happens as players get older, and this is true for running backs especially, is you become more injury prone. It is such a demanding physical position. And in Minnesota, I mean, they have Ty Chandler, but it's not like they have a stable of guys to play together. He's going to have to get a lot of carries. Oddly, in an offense where Kevin O'Connell didn't want to throw the ball at all last year, and now it's Sam Darnold. Like, it seems hard for me to believe that the $1 million was worth it to go play in a materially worse situation in Minnesota. But I think there's also a chance that, you know, Jones can't misjudge the market a little bit, that they felt like they could get more. And that's not ultimately what happened here.
Yep, no doubt. Good stuff, Pete. Appreciate it as always, pal. We'll talk again soon, okay?
All right, thanks, Bill.
Thanks so much. There you go. Peter Bukowski, the Locked On Packers podcast, co-founder of The Leap, joining us on the hotline. If there's a story by Rob Domofsky, I'll get a little bit deeper into it when we come back. But basically, Aaron Jones and Drew Rosenhaus over the weekend got into the discussion with the Green Bay Packers and did not want to take the 50% pay cut. They just didn't want to go there. And it became clear to the Packers that it wasn't going to happen. Maybe they thought that the Packers would say, okay, we'll give you a couple million more. Who knows? But at the Packers have made the decision, like, we're cutting them. We're going to move on. We're not going to continue to negotiate. We're going to move on. And then they found what they wanted. So on Monday, that's part of the thing is they said, look, we could have waited to cut Aaron Jones until the new league year started. They chose not to give him the opportunity to go out and seek another team. And there was apparently an offer almost immediately from the Vikings on the table. And for a little bit more than what the Packers had wanted to pay him, and he ended up coming out a little bit ahead in that area. And there you go. That's the way that kind of worked out. But it might have been to the point where the Packers thought, here's the value. He thought, maybe it's not the value. Or maybe, look at what I've done for you. Give me a little bit more. Give me something else to chew on. And the Packers just said, no, we're not going to. And thus went ahead and made the decision over the weekend to basically move on. And that's what transpired yesterday. So there you go. Pretty interesting stuff, though. Let's do this. We'll step away. We'll take a quick break. We'll come back. We'll get a lot more into it. Got to say hi to our guys at Big Boar Barbecue. Big Boar Barbecue. If you are out into the West Salem, La Crosse area, and you have not had this, you got to stop in and try it. If you've already tried it, you know exactly what I'm talking about. And they cater. So there's lunches, there's dinners, and catering, whether it's the dry rub, the dry rub ribs, which is fantastic, or the saucy ribs with maybe the pulled pork. How about the mac and cheese, the coleslaw, everything? There's burgers. There's all kinds of stuff. And the pulled pork sandwiches are out of this world. And their sausage, many, many different types of sauces to choose from. That's Big Boar Barbecue. It is family owned. Good people there. Really, really good people there. Big Boar Barbecue. Call them 608-612-0387. 608-612-0387. That's Big Boar Barbecue. Go to BigBoarBBQ.com. That is BigBoarBBQ.com right there in West Salem. More of the Bill Michaels Show next. Ready?
This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes.
Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes.
Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute.
Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
There is a company that works along with side, a company called Provisor. Provisor, a real estate company, and they work a lot with mortgages. Then their other company that is alongside them is called Veterans America. And they do, first of all, they're a huge supporter of the motorcycle ride coming up on Sunday, September 1st. So thanks to James Mercado and the gang at Veterans America and Provisor. But the Provisor has been around a long time. And then they started seeing veterans and such that were in military members that were not necessarily being treated right by a lot of different realty companies and mortgage companies and such out there. So they came up with Veterans America, and they actually concentrate on veterans and military members that have certain perks via the VA, and they understand it, and they can get you a better deal than what a lot of, say, credit unions and banks and such can get you, because they know it and they know the ins and outs of this stuff. But like I said, they're huge supporters of ours, and they really, and you know me, I'll do a lot of stuff with a lot of the military and first responders and such that are really, really good at what they do and really care about those who care about us. So if you are a military member, if you are a veteran, if you're a family member and you're thinking about a new home, refi of a mortgage, zero down payments, no PMI, maybe a little bit looser credit requirement, they know how to get kind of navigate all of that. Call James 262-745-3333, 262-745-3333. It's Veterans America, and they really do. They know what they're doing, and they have helped a lot of people. I've read you numerous emails on the air about people that have gotten a much, much better deal and a much, much better mortgage rate on their homes and on their refis because they work with Veterans America and the people that know exactly what it is they're doing and how to help those that have been in the military. And military members, like I said, military members, veterans, and their families. So give them a call. Again, 262-745-3333, 262-745-3333. That is Veterans America, Veterans America. Here's one question. I know there's a lot of talk regarding the NFL. I understand that. Tonight you got the Bucks on the road and they're the last game of the West Coast swing. They got Sacramento tonight. Grant, would you consider this West Coast trip a success? They're 1-2.
Actually, I would. I know the record isn't indicative. They should have beat the Lakers. D'Angelo Russell hit some shots and you tip your cap. If they beat the Kings tonight or look really, really, really good and lose when the Kings play really good, yeah, I'll consider it a success because I see Giannis and Dame really starting to play together and the role players kind of falling in line behind them. I really think they're trending in the right direction. I know the record doesn't say it on this road trip, but I've been impressed.
I get that about Dame and Giannis, but I still see a lot of the same stuff. You know, I see not valuing the possession at times. You know, granted, you can't help it if you just miss some shots. If you're just not hitting, I get it. But, you know, I don't want to see them revert back defensively to what they were. And they had a couple of missteps against the Lakers. And I'm like, what are you doing? You know, now it could also be that you've got a mind out there that's, you know, Darvin Ham that knows Giannis and company pretty well, knows a lot of those guys and some of their weaknesses. So he can exploit that. But I was disappointed in the Lakers game. The Golden State game bothered me because Golden State had not been playing that well. But then all of a sudden, you know, Golden State is now back and they're healthy and they played really well that night. They seem to be rejuvenated specifically at home. But the Laker game kind of disappointed me. I just thought that they could have done more. They could have been a little more aggressive defensively. They could have been a little more aggressive beyond the arc, and they weren't. And to me, that was very reminiscent of what they've done at times prior this season. So I want to see them win and win with some style points tonight against Sacramento. And then I'll feel Sacramento a little bit better.
Sacramento can't play defense at all.
No.
Their defense is completely in the tubes. So there should be no lack of style, really, for either team. I'm with you about the Warriors. The Warriors game didn't bother me as much because the Warriors got embarrassed on Sunday against the Celtics. The Bucks had won at that point six games in a row. It was probably due to course correct for both teams. The Lakers game was a big bummer. But the way they showed up and handled a Clippers team on Sunday, what they did to the Clippers on Sunday, to me, outweighed my frustration with the Lakers game. So that's a big part of how I view the last week or so.
So I would agree tonight. Maybe it changes my mind a little bit. I just was hoping they'd go like, you know, 3-1. 3-1, have style points. Maybe you have one clunker, but 3-1 and really kind of close out some games because these are some of the games you need to close out. You need to kind of, you know, effort towards that going down the stretch here. So we'll see how they play tonight. And like I said, in the meantime, you've got UWM, the Panthers tonight, taking on Oakland, 6 o'clock down in Indianapolis. If they win, they're within. They're going to be within the tournament. They're going to be within the realm of 64. And I can't wait. Looking forward to it. Hopefully they get there. So root like crazy tonight for a team right here in our own backyard. It would be great to have three collegiate basketball teams in the NCAA tournament. Whether or not they get to, you know, the second round, we'd have to wait and see. But nevertheless, I'm excited for college hoops this year. Excited for the brackets, all that kind of good stuff. Always am. And then obviously excited for Girl Scout cookies. They got to start showing up too. I haven't had those happen at the house yet either. I haven't had that box dropped off. So got to get the Girl Scout cookies. Let's do this. A little bit earlier, Matthew Collier, he is with the Purple Insider, and he gave us the lowdown on the Aaron Jones deal, what's going on in Minneapolis, Kirk Cousins leaving, Sam Darnold coming in, what's next for the people in purple. And he spoke with us a little bit earlier today. Many of you don't get a chance to hear it because it was the first hour of the program. So you're going to hear that coming up. Don't go anywhere. We got a lot more of the Bill Michaels Show coming up right after this. This portion of the program brought to you by our friends over there. Over at Great Lakes Dragway. Great Lakes Dragway. We are, Roy's a good dude, man. Not only is Great Lakes Dragway, they redid some of their infrastructure and they continue to get bigger and better down there in Union Grove, but also he is putting in a multi-purpose sports complex in the middle of just above the city of Milwaukee because there's some high schools and such that don't have one. And he said, I'll do it. So he's trying to help out some of the schools and some of the kids and some of the youth programs there. So kudos to them, man. Great Lakes Dragway, Union Grove, Wisconsin, caring about the community, but more so your 2024 season pass and need for speed. It's on 262-302-2138, 262-302-2138, or go to greatlakesdragway.com. That's greatlakesdragway.com. It's almost race season, my friends.
This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
0% interest for up to 3 years at Pella Windows and Doors of Wisconsin. I'm Gina Della from Pella. Pella's free in-home consultations make replacing or redesigning your windows and doors easy. We go beyond just measuring and handing you a quote. We take the time to listen and educate you on all your product options. And with Design Works, you can see what your home will look like before you buy. Whether you're looking to replace your windows due to damage or it's time for a refresh and you'd like to revitalize your home style, choosing from Pella's wide range of windows and doors will complement your home's unique design. Pella can also customize, providing nearly endless possibilities for maximum design flexibility with dramatic sizes, custom colors, finishes, profiles, product types, and more. Order by March 31st to get 0% interest for up to 3 years. Set your free consultation at PellaWI.com.
Certain restrictions apply.
Bill Michaels will resume in 5 minutes.
Michaels will resume in 4 minutes.
Michaels will resume in 3 minutes.
Bill Michaels will resume in 2 minutes.
Michaels will resume in 1 minute.
Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
Glad to have you back to the program. Our friends at Boondocks Barbecue Burgers and Brews on County Road K in Oconomowoc. Just kind of a reminder, they got all kinds of things happening out there. They've got Boondocks and Old Smokey with the Moonshine Girls. That's coming up. They have live music, and that's going to take place on St. Patrick's Day. So the Moonshine Girls, Boondocks, Old Smokey, all going to be out there going on. So if you're looking for something to do on St. Patrick's Day, that's a place you may want to swing into and say howdy. So they're going to be open and rocking on Friday, Saturday, obviously fish frying Friday and Saturday their normal hours, and then Sunday on St. Patrick's Day you're going to see the Moonshine Girls that are going to be out there. Lucky Raffles, there's going to be live music. The Stallion Wagon is going to be playing out there that day. So if you're looking for something to do, that's Boondock Barbecue Burgers and Brews, County Road K in Oconomowoc. A couple of things real quick. The Giants signing the quarterback Drew Lock as a veteran backup to Daniel Jones. So Drew Lock now going to the Giants. In the meantime, Shelby Harris, he's got a deal in place, and he is going to remain the big defensive tackle, signing a 2-year deal to stay with the Cleveland Browns. And today on Capitol Hill, you had Nick Saban went to Capitol Hill today to talk about the negative effects of the NIL and what's going on in college athletics regarding the NIL. So that's all taking place today as well. Patrick Queen signs over with, he goes to the Steelers. And by the way, Chase Young is out visiting today, the former pass rusher with the 49ers. He is set to visit with the Panthers and the Saints and a few other teams that are expressing interest in him as well. So Chase Young could be on the move sooner rather than later. So there you go. That being said, Matt Collier, he is with the Purple Insider. He joined us a little bit earlier today just to talk some about, well, first and foremost, the exodus of Kirk Cousins, where they're at right now as a franchise, and then obviously the incoming Aaron Jones. Here's Matt Collier from earlier today.
Matthew Collier, the Purple Insider, joining us on the highlight. Matthew, how you doing?
I'm good. Do they make you say chicken, 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 chicken like that? Or is that like you?
That is me. I love that stuff. I got to be honest with you. I'm like addicted to it. So you're one of, look, when I come to Minnesota, there's two things I stop at. One is Quick Trip and the other one is Antigo's. So both of those are on my radar every time I come in that direction. So
I can really feel the passion.
Yes. Let's talk about, first and foremost, give me the state of where this team is. I mean, they lose Kirk Cousins. They pick up Sam Darnold, and then they go out and get a running back to fill in because, obviously, Alexander Mattison is gone. But what are they doing right now? If you had to say, I'm going to put my thumb on what the Vikings are doing, what are they doing right now?
I think that they are sticking to the plan that was laid out when Kwesi Adofo-Mensah and Kevin O'Connell took over their leadership in 2022. I mean, they wanted to try to compete in 2022. They knew the division was down. They thought they had a chance. They also thought if they increased the culture and made it a little bit nicer of a place to work, they might win some more games. And then they tore down last year major parts of their roster and set themselves up to draft a quarterback this year. I think that was their three-year plan from where they started. And when you look back to last year, they negotiated a little bit with Kirk Cousins on an extension, but ultimately didn't sign him. So it shouldn't be shocking that he left, because they had their opportunity after he won 13 games to give him the big monster $100 million guaranteed deal. And they said, no, we're not going to do that, because you're an older, middling type of quarterback. And apparently the Falcons don't mind, but the Vikings did not have that in their plans. So now they're set up to spend a lot of free agency money, which they have not had a chance to do since Kirk has been there. And so they're rebuilding their defense with guys who are in their mid to late 20s, still in their prime, with three signings on the defensive side. And I think Aaron Jones is kind of a bit of a luxury signing for them. A little bit of like when you get your mortgage paid off, that you go out and buy yourself the biggest ribeye you can find. I think that's getting Aaron Jones here. But they need a better running game if they're going to draft a quarterback as well. You can't ask a quarterback to do what Kirk did and have the 27th best running game like the Vikings did last year. So I think it's all kind of coming together the way they envisioned it. And what will ultimately determine success or failure is pretty simple. It's what they end up doing in the draft at the quarterback position.
Who do you think that they are targeting, if anybody specific?
I think that Drake May, if there was any opportunity to trade up, that they would gather all the draft capital and ship it to Washington or New England if they had a chance. He just makes so much sense for Kevin O'Connell. Big arm. He's a good athlete. Kind of reminds you a little bit of Matthew Stafford when he was coming out of college, and that's who Kevin O'Connell won the Super Bowl with. So you could see that being a great combination. Of course, though, they pick 11th. Getting up that far would take a lot. So I think the next best option for them is probably J.J. McCarthy, who's getting a ton of buzz, and maybe the Giants want him. So you might have to trade up to even get J.J. McCarthy, but not give up the whole franchise. But with bringing in Sam Darnold, it gives them a little bit of wiggle room to draft someone like McCarthy, pretend they're the Packers a little bit and develop the guy for a year and then have him ready to play in 2025. But I also think this is just a draft that has a lot of guys you can like. I mean, you watch Michael Penix and his arm talent, or you look at the numbers Bo Nix put up, and you know, some of these guys are kind of being treated like second-class prospects, but they're better than a lot of the prospects that we've seen in the past go in the first round. So I think the Vikings have had their eye on this class for a couple of years, and we're leading up to this to have this opportunity to pick their guys.
How much, I know he's cost a lot of money, but what are fans saying? Because I've said all along, look, you're talking about Kirk Cousins, and he's been a tremendous quarterback during the regular season. You've got a guy that's $330 million into a career and has only won one playoff game. So, I mean, is there a lot of, are you kidding me, that he's now gone and no longer a Minnesota Viking going on?
I think that Vikings fans feel like they have walked out into the fresh air. Because they've just heard the same old things over and over again over the last 6 years of, well, you know, if Kirk only had a better left guard, if Kirk only had a better offensive coordinator, if he only had a coach who liked him, if he only had a defense, if only. And as you mentioned, he has fewer playoff wins in his career than Baker Mayfield does. And yet he's been playing for a long time and he's made a lot of money. And they made the playoffs 2 times in 6 years during his tenure. Is that competing? I don't think so. Would the Packers organization say that's competing? No, I wouldn't think so. So I think for Vikings fans, they got very exhausted and frustrated by having a quarterback that's good and not great. It's the worst place you can live. It's where the Raiders lived with Derek Carr for a very long time. Those guys can fool you into thinking that, no, yeah, if you just do this or that, he can really take you somewhere. Well, not at $40 million a year, he can't. So, I mean, that's where you look at, you know, the 49ers, the Eagles, teams that have built around these rookie quarterback contracts. That's what the Vikings are looking to do. And I think fans are just more informed than ever. And they understand this. They're like, this is the way to go. This is how teams are winning in the NFL. And so I don't think it's like sayonara loser. I mean, I think that fans liked Kirk Cousins overall and rooted for him, but also realized that it was just not the way to get anywhere in the NFL. And, you know, congratulations to the Atlanta Falcons on their 9-8 season upcoming.
Let me ask you this, because I've got people that are asking me, is there anything to the notion, or I'm watching right now on the NFL Network and the rumors and innuendos flying around, would there be anything to Justin Fields wearing purple next year?
Doesn't make a bit of sense to me, man. But, you know, I guess, like, if you're the Vikings, you have to investigate every option. And maybe there's some sort of price where, if it's like the same price that Mac Jones went for, if you're talking about a day three pick, then maybe. But I still don't get it. Like, the guy's 10-28 in his career. He gets sacked at a rate that's higher than David Carr. Remember the Texans quarterback who got sacked all the time? Well, actually, Fields gets sacked more often than him. So I don't see that as a fit for a coach who loves a rhythm and timing offense like Kevin O'Connell. That's where a big-armed quarterback like Sam Darnold makes more sense, even if he hasn't had a ton of success so far in his career. But Justin Fields hasn't done anything Sam Darnold or Mac Jones did, and Chicago fans are treating him like he's incredible. It's very bizarre how much they fell in love with this guy who has never even thrown for 2,600 yards. Like, what year is it? Guys were throwing for 26 yards in 1985.
Which I completely agree with. I think he had a couple of good games down the stretch, and they thought he was going to just get his price driven up to some kind of magnanimous proportion. And he's at best maybe a sixth-round draft choice at this point and really hasn't proven too much in Chicago. And I'll be quite honest with you. What we were told behind the scenes is that he's not the sharpest knife in the drawer anyway. So I don't know necessarily what franchise is going to take a big flyer on Justin Fields. However, what needs to be done in Minnesota still? Because you've obviously still got a tremendous wide receiver in Justin Jefferson. You just pick up Aaron Jones, who can be a receiver out of the backfield. He's still got a burst. He doesn't have the same level of speed, breakaway speed that he used to have, but he's still got a good burst and still can churn in yardage. What else needs to be done, maybe even to the defensive side of things in Minnesota?
And can we just stop for a minute and just like marvel at how many times this has happened with a Packer being disgruntled? Like, no, I'm going to Quick Trip in Minnesota. That's what I'm going to do. Like, it's so funny. I mean, how often this happens. It gives us a little spice for a revenge game. But there's a lot to do. They signed 3 defensive players, a couple pass rushers, linebacker. But they need defensive tackle badly. So if you want to cut Kenny Clark, the Vikings would take him as well. But I mean, that guy is just like, they finally got rid of Fletcher Cox in Philly. Now if only Kenny Clark can retire. But they need a defensive tackle badly. They need a left guard. They don't have a starting left guard. And the guard prices all of a sudden are absolutely insane. So I think they're going to have to wait for that. So this is under construction. Like, you can see the build happening. But I think it's not until really next offseason where they can go completely wild in their spending. So this is going to be still, I think, a transition year for the Vikings overall.
Always good to talk to you. We appreciate all the information. I'm sure we'll touch base back as the draft is upon us, okay?
Yep, good to talk to you, man. Thanks for having me.
You too. There you go, Matthew Collar. He joined us for a couple of minutes earlier today. Let's do this. We're going to hear from Adam Schefter, something he had to say. That's rather ear-raising. Stay tuned. We got more of the Bill Michaels Show wrapping it up, coming up next.
covering Wisconsin sports like a blanket. This is the Bill Michaels Show on the Wisconsin Sports Zone Radio Network.
Hey, hungry? And your heart is ticking for chicken? Well, take a quick turn and a quick trip because we got
no ordinary chicken.
Yeah, go wild with wings. Next level super wings with trusty sidekick and sauces. Or let's talk tender. Quick chick tenders. Love me tenders. Love me some quick tenders. Ours are bigger, better, tastier. Or if you're feeling good old school comfort fried chicken, we got it. Hand breaded down homier than anywhere. Quick Trip, saving your nuggets from ordinary.
Bill Michaels will resume in 3 minutes.
Michaels will resume in 2 minutes.
Bill Michaels will resume in 1 minute.
Bill Michaels will resume in 30 seconds.
To go before we get out of here. Glad to have you back. And tomorrow we'll wrap things up with the Bucks on that West Coast trip. You've got UWM hopefully finding themselves into the big dance if they get a win tonight over Oakland. Thursday, got the Badgers back at it. Marquette's going to be in the Big East tournament. We got a lot of college hoops to talk about and more NFL free agency, Brewers stuff, all kinds of stuff. We haven't even talked about Devin Williams and the back end of the bullpen injury. So we haven't even gotten into that yet. However, before we get out of here, Adam Schefter, now, Grant, he was talking about what, Justin Fields and the Bears?
Yeah, this is on First Take, just a little bit of an update and some commentary on his market, or lack thereof, right now.
What do these quarterback moves mean for interest in Justin Fields specifically?
Well, listen, Justin Fields was connected to Atlanta. Never happened. They went and signed Kirk Cousins. He was connected to Pittsburgh. They land Russell Wilson. He was connected to Las Vegas. They went with Gardner Minshew. So all the places that have come up in connection, to Justin Fields have looked to other places. What's amazing to me about this is that Justin Fields is due to. So the teams that are looking at him would be looking at him as a backup. And would Chicago then get the value that it wants? And what does Chicago do about that? This right now is an ongoing situation. It reminds me a little bit in a certain way of Lamar Jackson last year. Lamar becomes a free agent. We're saying, well, he fits in Washington. They don't make a move. He fits in Atlanta. They don't make a move. He fits in so many places. None of them make moves. Similar conversation with Justin Fields this year. And here he is back in Chicago, and the Bears will have to wait to see what opportunities arise. But it certainly doesn't seem right now like anything is imminent with Justin Fields.
Interesting. And here's part of it is the Bears, for the most part, have made it clear that they're going to move on from Justin Fields. They know that. Everybody knows that. So while the market may be very, very down for Justin Fields, I'm sure there's somebody out there that would say, hey, we'll take a flyer on him. What the hell? It's just, you know, for, as we talked about earlier, for the Bears fans, it became delusional thinking this guy was going to draw you another first round draft choice. You're smoking rope. Ain't happening. He's in his career in Chicago. He's giving you maybe 10 good games. Maybe. And that's not even a season. In what, three seasons as a starter? So four seasons as a starter. It's just there's no market for him right now. And like I said, it appears, at least via many, that when you talk about the Bears and you talk about people that cover the Bears, they've all kind of whispered very quietly the same thing, that he's not the brightest when it comes to quarterback play.
Real quick, I know we're running out of time. It's one thing for Atlanta to choose Kirk Cousins over Justin Fields. Sam Darnold and Gardner Minshew for more money than Justin Fields. Those are the jarring decisions by the Kirk is whatever, but some of these other quarterback decisions, it's like, damn, tell us how you really feel about
100%. 100%. All right, that's going to do it. That is going to do it. Good stuff. And we're going to be back. And it's only Tuesday. Going to be back at it again tomorrow. Hopefully UWM gets a win tonight. We're talking about another team from the state of Wisconsin heading to the Big Dance. Bucks hopefully get a win tonight as well. I got a lot of hoops tonight. And then whatever else happens to come our way, we'll get back into it again tomorrow.